Good morning. Thank you so much to everyone for being here today. I'm Jane Thorpe, Chair of the Task Force for Global Health. It has truly been an honor to support the work of the creative, caring, and effective global health experts at the Task Force for the past 13 years. The Task Force Board is a group of dedicated people with immeasurable collective wisdom. Several of them are here with us today. Carol Walters, Sir George Aline, Paula Lawton Bevington, Pete McTeer, John Hardman, Mary Riley. Thank you to you all. John and Mary are stepping down this year, so a special thank you to both of them for their service. I also want to thank the Carter Center for hosting us today. The Task Force and the Carter Center are longtime partners and good friends. Today's event is being webcast live so that people around the world can join us and make it a truly global gathering. And one housekeeping matter, you have snacks on your table to sustain you throughout this program, so please enjoy them at any time you would like. The Task Force for Global Health works to mobilize partnerships to improve the health and well-being of people around the world. The simplicity and humility of our mission mask the force at the Task Force, the hardworking, brilliant public health heroes who have chosen to make their life's task a fight against the twin enemies of global health: polarization and poverty. Polarization. Polarization afflicts the world of public health like it does everything else, and aren't we all frustrated and exhausted by it? Nations and the politicians that lead them, NGOs, corporations, funders, doctors and scientists working in public health are frequently divided, often disagree, and almost always are competing for limited resources. The task force antidote to the poison of polarization? Collaboration. The task force invites key stakeholders to collaborate on the development of innovative solutions to public health problems. By mastering the subject matter, listening to what everybody has to say, asking the hard questions, never taking personal credit for success, and never giving up, the task force converts stakeholders into partners who stand together on common ground. Poverty. There is simply far too much disparity between wealth and health in our world. Using all the tools in the toolbox, the task force has tackled the diseases of extreme poverty, delivering billions of dollars of donated pharmaceuticals and vaccines, deploying new technologies, strengthening healthcare systems, inviting unexpected partners into collaborations, and always thinking creatively. During the program today, we're going to hear from a panel of true global health leaders, and I know this will be inspiring, but more importantly, it will be useful. With the powerhouse of global health and development leaders here with us today, we are bound to gain greater insights into the challenges and opportunities we face in ending diseases of extreme poverty. As many of you probably know, Mark Rosenberg will be retiring as president and CEO of the task force at the beginning of the next year. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank him for leading this organization so compassionately and effectively for the past 16 years. During that time, he has led the task force to immense growth and success. Like many people, I claim Mark Rosenberg as my mentor, and working with him has provided me with some of the most meaningful experiences of my life. Mark is the living embodiment of a phrase that gets used around the task force a lot, consequential compassion. And it's not just me that thinks that. Just a few weeks ago, Mark received the Governor's Lifetime Achievement Award for the impact he has had on the health of people all over the world. We will miss Mark at the task force, but luckily, we already had a great successor ready to step into his big shoes right under our roof. Dave Ross, who is currently the director of the Task Force's Public Health Informatics Institute, as well as our Vice President for Program Development, will become the new president and CEO of the task force in the coming year. With a rare combination of brilliance and high-tech bottom-line thinking, coupled with a deep compassion for humanity and, if you know Dave, a genuine joy for life, he is the right person to lead the task force into the future. Before I turn things over to Mark, I want to pass along a message from a woman I met during a trip I was fortunate to make to Ethiopia on behalf of the task force. I was there to learn about trachoma, which is the leading infectious cause of blindness in the world, with which the task force and the pharmaceutical company Pfizer and the Carter Center and many organizations are working to eliminate by the year 2020. At one event during my trip, a group of women lined up in a row, eager to share their personal accounts of trachoma and the effects of the treatment they were receiving. But there was one woman in the line who said she didn't want to tell me a story. She said she had a favor to ask of me. And here's what the favor was. She said, "Please go back and tell people how your work has changed our lives." So to the members and supporters of the global health community here today, I pass on her message, the message of this wonderful Ethiopian woman. Your work is changing lives. The world is a better place because of it, and there is no better time to celebrate it than the 30th anniversary of the Task Force for Global Health. Thank you. Dr. Rosenberg?
Good morning. Good morning. And thank you, Jane. Your support and your gift to the world through chairing the task force board and steering us on the right course has been immeasurable. Thank you for all of that. This is a day to honor Bill Foege. My friend and brother, who you will hear from soon, Paul Farmer, has said that the root of all evil is the belief that some lives are worth more than others. The belief that some lives are worth more than others. Bill Foege has led his life in a way that shows he clearly rejects that belief. He rejects that notion that some lives are worth more than others. And global health equity is the moral compass that has guided his career. And we can see this thread running through his major accomplishments. I want to highlight two things, both what Bill has done, and with a little more trepidation, I will venture to share with you how Bill thinks, or at least how Mark thinks Bill thinks. And believe me, he is always, always thinking, and these days always thinking and always writing. What he has done is mind-boggling. Bill has saved millions of lives. Or to be precise, in an area where precision is impossible, on the website that tallies things like that, it's called scienceheroes.com, he's credited with saving 131 million lives, more than any other living person. He's expanded the reach of public health, forged a new concept called global health equity, and acted as a disruptor before disruption was even popular. Let me start with what he's done. In smallpox eradication, he brought about a paradigm shift that secured the holy grail for global health. In 1973, Bill convinced the Indian government to shift from their unsuccessful strategy of mass immunization to an approach he had pioneered called containment. The containment strategy, they adopted it, then he skillfully guided these surveillance and containment efforts. His team mapped the incidence of the disease in more than 700,000 villages. They mobilized 250,000 people, and by using the surveillance and containment method, they quickly contained the threat. India went from 87,000 cases of smallpox in 1973, more than any other country on earth, to no cases at all in the spring of 1975. His organizing 250,000 people to work together and achieve this is probably the pinnacle of collaboration. Bill helped to achieve something that had never been achieved before, the actual eradication of a disease from the face of the earth, from every single planet, every single country on the planet, maybe every single planet, we'll find out soon. In 1979, the World Health Organization did in fact declare smallpox eradicated. It was a disease that had killed hundreds of millions of people, and it had been driven from the face of the earth. Bill recognized that the eradication of smallpox had been a major step in achieving a degree of equity across the world, because everyone, no matter where they might live, would receive the benefit of a smallpox-free life. From that effort, all future generations would also benefit. Something else that he's done is in the realm of universal childhood immunization. In March 1984, Bill joined the leaders of the World Bank, the World Health Organization, UNDP, UNICEF, and the Rockefeller Foundation to create the Task Force for Child Survival. It was a small, low-profile coordinating body that would benefit from real collaboration and accelerate childhood immunizations in all countries so that rich and poor benefited by avoiding common childhood diseases. And they pulled off what was, in the words of Jim Grant, the director of UNICEF, the largest peacetime mobilization in the history of the earth. This is what we talk about when we talk about the task force model. Again, driven by equity and achieved through collaboration. The last thing he did I want to mention is the Mectazan donation program and the beginning of what we call pharmacophilanthropy. In 1987, Merck found that Mectazan, a drug they had developed to treat heartworm in animals, was able to protect humans from onchocerciasis, commonly known as river blindness, a devastating illness. Merck pledged to supply Mectazan free for as long as it would take to treat this disease in Africa if Dr. Foege and the task force would oversee its distribution. Some of Dr. Foege's closest advisors told him not to do this because historically there had been a long-standing battle between public health's interest in saving lives and the pharmaceutical company's interest in making a profit. But Bill dreamed about what might be achieved if this partnership were to work, and he went back to the CEO of Merck, and he said, yes, we'll do this with you. Through the Mectazan donation program, more than 1 billion doses have been administered to treat river blindness in LF in Africa and Latin America. All of this was made possible because Bill saw what could be achieved through collaboration and dared to make it happen. Finally, Bill is focused on the notion of global health equity, an idea that's become the rallying cry for an unprecedented level of interest in global health. Global health equity, in Bill's view, meant that everyone would have equal access to the tools and techniques available to protect health and safety. We have come so far, but we still have a long way to go. The lifetime risk for a Canadian woman dying from pregnancy complications of childbirth is 1 in 11,000. The lifetime risk for a woman in Niger is 1 in 7. Similarly, life expectancy at birth varies by over 50% depending on the country of birth. For those born in Canada or Japan and the US, the average life expectancy is 80 years or more, whereas in Afghanistan and Sierra Leone, life expectancy is approximately 40 years. An American child diagnosed with acute lymphoblastic leukemia has a 90% chance of being cured, but in the poorest countries of the world, more than 90% of the children diagnosed with this disease will die. Inequity persists. In his address to the World Health Assembly in 2000, Bill noted, "The world cannot be allowed to exist half healthy and half sick. There's a point in every movement where a line is crossed. There's a drop of water that finally causes a glass to overflow, a moment when a friendship becomes permanent, and a moment when a vaccine actually provides protection. There will be a moment when the phrase, the world cannot be allowed to exist half healthy and half sick, goes from being a nice statement to an actual commitment. Where there is no turning back, and the world, in the words of Toynbee, dares to think of the health of the whole human race as a practical objective." Remarkable things that he has done. But how Bill thinks is as remarkable as what he has accomplished. And there are four principles that I think capture how Bill thinks, or at least how he thinks about global health. The first is, he sees this as a cause and effect world. This is not a world in which stuff just happens. Things happen for a reason, and if we can understand the reasons by using science, then we can change the outcomes. And science gives us the power to understand, and once we understand, we can change things and change them for the better. This thinking leads directly to us becoming both activists and optimists. Second, he focuses on the future. If we can think upstream, we can find ways to prevent some of the bad consequences of disease, injuries, and poverty. Our greatest power is preventing things before they even happen. Reaching the goal of global health equity will require us to focus on the future. Bill has said, it's like building a cathedral. Global health equity is an undertaking that we take up, knowing that it will not be completed in our own lifetime. Third, Bill thinks about the entire population. Healthcare takes care of individuals, individuals that the practitioner meets and knows, but global health takes care of people we have never seen and may never meet, whole communities, whole countries, whole regions. In global health, we have a responsibility for those who are not even born, future generations that we may never see. Compassion is so much harder when you don't know or see the people you are working to help. And fourth, Bill sees both the whole and the parts at the same time. Julio Frank, the former dean of the Harvard School of Public Health, has called the greatest threat to global health dichotomous thinking, the Manichaean fixation on false dilemmas that continues to pull members of the global health community apart. This thread of dichotomous thinking that things must be black or white, good or bad, prevention or treatment, global or local, them or us. Bill rejects dichotomous thinking and tells us we need to see the numbers and the faces at the same time. This cannot devolve into a contest between the hard number crunchers with their metrics and those who are driven by compassion. We need both. Each and every one of us needs both. In the task force lobby, we have Bill's words. If we are to maintain the reputation the task force now enjoys, it will be because in everything we do, behind everything we say, as the basis for every program decision we make, we will be willing to see faces. This is a call for compassion. In an age dominated by discussions of costs and benefits, program effectiveness, measurable outcomes, and health metrics, it is a serious challenge from an extraordinary man. I'm proud to introduce to you Bill Foege.
I believe this is my definition of misery. And Mark is such a smooth talker, I don't even know what to believe. I'm sort of at an awkward age of old enough that people think they have to say nice things, and young enough that I still surprise them by breathing. And you'll see why I'm put off by this, because Mark has spent so much of his life trying to make me miserable. And so this takes me by surprise. I was prepared for rebuttal. Mark once prepared an introduction for someone in Australia. I was the closing speaker for a conference, and Mark did an entire introduction that was totally false. There wasn't anything in it that was true, but this person didn't know it. And so he gave me the introduction, and Mark was sitting there gloating because he knew I could not get up and say, that's not true. But you see, he's continuing it this morning. So I do want to say a few things about Mark, but first, a few things about the history of what happened, because I feel so fortunate that we are usually in a position of trying to figure out why did something not work. With the task force, for some reason, things always work better than we could have imagined. And sometimes we thought we just have to get out of the way because things are better than imagined. It started when President Carter decided to improve the immunization program in the United States. And he called Joseph Califano, the secretary, and said he wanted an improvement in immunization. Joseph Califano called me, and he said, I want to set a goal of 90% of children immunized by the time they start school. I called Don Millar, the late Don Millar, who died just a couple of months ago, and he was in charge of immunization in the United States, and I asked him, could we set this goal of 90%? And he said, we've not achieved that at any project that we've tried on immunization. He said, I would hate to see that in my job description. The next day, Don and I both saw that in our job descriptions. And what actually happened was, again, better than we could have imagined. We got to 90%, 91, 92, 95. Then we realized we actually had to get to children by the second birthday rather than school age. And Alan Hinman and Walt Orenstein and other people are here who actually made that program work. It became such a good program. Vaccine preventable diseases went right down, sometimes to zero. And then we got the courage to ask, could we interrupt measles transmission, the most contagious of the diseases? And many people thought we couldn't and thought it would be bad for CDC to even adopt that as an objective because we would look silly. And we would ruin the reputation of CDC. We did accept it as an objective. And week by week, we would have a meeting, 30 minutes. What have we learned this week? What do we need to do? By the mid-80s, we had interrupted transmission of measles in this country. Since that time, every case of measles in this country can be traced back to an importation. So the program really was very good here. Well, in 1974, WHO started a program of immunization, expanded program for immunization, because they were so happy with what was happening with smallpox eradication. And it had an Atlanta connection because Rafe Henderson, a CDC person on loan to WHO, headed up the program. 9 years later, they really had a very superb program, but they were so disconcerted by the fact that only about 14% of children were being reached by measles vaccine. 4.3 million children dying every year just because of measles and tetanus and pertussis. So it was slow. They wanted things to improve. Then about this time, Jonas Salk becomes concerned about, could we increase globally to the point we have in the United States? And he went to talk with Robert McNamara, the former president of the World Bank. The two of them went to Ken Warren, who worked at the Rockefeller Foundation. He went to his president, Dick Lyman, and they began asking, what could we do? Rockefeller offered to have a meeting in Bellagio, Italy, and bring people together to see, could we improve what happens to global immunization? And this took place in March of 1984. But then an interesting thing happened before that meeting. Jim Grant, the director of UNICEF, and Hoften Mahler, the director of WHO, came to see me personally. The two of them had had trouble getting along in certain things. Mahler wanted to have primary health care or horizontal programs. Jim Grant wanted to selectively go after four things: growth monitoring, oral rehydration, breastfeeding, and immunization. He thought that's the quickest way to bring down child mortality. So the two of them couldn't quite get together on this. They came to me, and I tell you, I felt like I was a therapist. Because they said, we both have such big egos, we sometimes have trouble getting along. It's no wonder that UNICEF and WHO go into countries with different messages, and they compete, they try to get some recognition for what they're doing. And if we go to Bellagio, and if we form a task force to figure out how to better work together, they asked me if I would be willing to head it up. Well, I was in the process of stepping down from CDC, and so I agreed to do that. The meeting was, they told me three things. That number one, I could never have a high enough profile to obscure them. And I said, that may be hard for me, but I could do it. Number two, that we could not compete with UNICEF and WHO. And number three, we could not use the word coordination. They said, our organizations do not want to be coordinated. So we settled on the word facilitation. And in March of 1994, the meeting was held in Bellagio. The bilateral agencies, such as USAID, were totally against a task force. They said, what the world does not need is one more organization. But Jim Grant was so powerful and so influential that he pushed that through. And so the task force was formed, headquarters in Atlanta, and Carol Walters, Bill Watson, and myself started the task force. We formed a 501c3 organization, and then we did two things that, in retrospect, are so powerful. I went to Jim Mason, the new director of CDC. He had asked me to stay on to do some projects for him. I asked, could I spend half my time on the task force and have CDC pay? And he said yes. So now we had CDC employees. I was paid by CDC. It meant we had access to all of CDC, all the scientists at CDC. I then went and talked to Jim Laney, the president of Emory, and told him what we hoped to do. And Jim Laney was very much in favor of a university actually providing service. I asked, could we embed a 501c3 organization in Emory so we don't have to do all the things of coming up with retirement policies and travel forms and all the things that HR does? And he agreed to that. Now, he said there are two things. Number one, there has to be overhead. And he said, what if we charge you 8%? I couldn't believe it. I said, yes, so fast, so that he wouldn't have a chance to rethink that. And number two, he said, you have to answer to someone in Emory. He said, I think I would like you to answer to the dean of the medical school. Jim Laney had no idea that I've known that dean for 20 years, and every conversation would start out with no. And so I said, well, that might work, but let me present one other idea first. What if I answered to you if I promised never to bother you? And he had a quizzical look, and then he said, okay. And so I did report every once in a while on what was happening, but I don't think I ever actually bothered him. And so now we had access to all of Emory, and things began to improve. Much of it was smoke and mirrors. Every 3 months, we would have a meeting of the five principal agents, WHO, UNICEF, World Bank, UNDP, and the Rockefeller Foundation. And we would try to figure out what are the problems to improving immunization, what has to happen. And we got WHO and UNICEF to put out joint documents. Every quarterly meeting, we could show an increase in the immunization level. Our objective was to go from 20% coverage to 80% in 6 years by 1990. In retrospect, I don't see how we had the courage to have an objective that was that high. But things continued to improve, and we got a group of people that trusted each other. And trust is the glue of a coalition that will actually work. And so, as Mark said, September 30th, 1990, there was a children's summit at the UN. And at that summit, 71 heads of state came. It was pageantry. Each head of state taken to their seat by a child in national dress. Each head of state given 5 minutes to tell what they have done for the health of children, what they intend to do. It was positive peer pressure as the day went on, of people promising more and more. And 70 of the 71 actually stayed within their 5 minutes. Now, this is incredible. I mean, these have to be some of the biggest egos in the world. And 70 of the 71 stayed within their 5 minutes. And that's when Jim Grant said, this is the biggest peacetime operation the world has ever seen. Robert McNamara, both at Bellagio and afterwards, had talked about if we could get $100 million new dollars for immunization, everything would change. People continued to tell him there's no way we will get $100 million new dollars. 2 years after that Bellagio meeting, none of us would have settled for $100 million new dollars. Italy alone gave $100 million for immunization in Africa. And then they increased it from $100 million to $120 million. So things continued to improve. And then Jim Grant died and Hoffmann-Mahler left WHO. And one of the lessons of a coalition is you have to have the heads of the agencies wanting this to work. It doesn't happen at a lower level. My thought had been to disband the task force at the point that we reached the 80% in 1990. But some things that happened that made that a little difficult. One was Merck coming to us with Mectizan. And this was a drug that Merck had already decided they could not make a profit on before Roy Vagelos, who was then head of research, gave the money to do the research in Africa. They had already figured out they couldn't make money on it, but he decided to do it. By the time they found that this program prevented blindness, he was the CEO of Merck. And now he decided they had to give it away. They tried to give it away first to WHO. And they said, we'll give you the drug free if you figure out how to deliver it. And they finally left because the bureaucracy was so great at WHO they couldn't work. They went to USAID with the same offer. We'll give you the drug free if you deliver it. And USAID just said no, they weren't interested. So then they came to the task force. And it took us a little while to be comfortable with this because we worried about side effects and how do you convince people about taking a drug if they don't see the results for 20 years of not being blind. All of those problems just disappeared so fast because it turns out that people with onchocerciasis are scratching, itching all the time. Some of them wake up, it's the first thing they know in the morning. It's the last thing they know at night. And then you see people that actually take rocks trying to get deep into the itch. They would take this drug, Mectazan, and some of them the next day would have their first itch-free day in their life. You don't have to do marketing. I mean, the word spreads and people are ready to do this. And a year later, you come back and they're lining up to do it. We set out to reach 6 million people in 6 years, and we did it in 4 years, and then it just increased so fast. I went back to Africa for the 250 millionth free treatment from Merck. They have now given over 1 billion free treatments. And you know what they've gotten in return? They've gotten a group of people who like working for a company that does the right thing socially. They ended up benefiting from this, and they weren't anticipating that sort of a benefit. But now we had that program going. And then a very strange thing happened. We were having a Mectazan program in France. I was chairing it. A Thursday night, just before we broke for dinner, Eric Otteson, who was working for WHO at the time, and I saw him come in, so I know he's here someplace. Eric Otteson ended up giving a report on a study WHO had done where they showed that the use of two drugs, Mectazan and a drug called albendazole, had a benefit in lymphatic filariasis. This is elephantiasis, where people get swelling of the legs and scrotum and so forth. We were very excited. Someone asked, who makes albendazole? And the answer was Smith Kline Beecham. Does anyone know someone high enough in the company that we could get free albendazole and start a new program? No one did. But we were so excited, and that's what we talked about at dinner. The next morning, I'm chairing the meeting. This is in France. 10 o'clock in the morning, someone puts a slip of paper in front of me that Jimmy Carter's on the phone. Would you take the call? And sure, you know the answer. And so we had a coffee break. President Carter said, I'm so excited. He said, it's 5 o'clock in the morning in Atlanta. I'm so excited I have to talk to you. He said, does the name Jan Leschly mean anything to you? And I said, no. He said, last night I had dinner with him in Washington, D.C., and he talked about Merck giving Mectazan and the value he saw for the employees now feeling that they're working for a company that really has social responsibility. And President Carter said, Jan Leschly is president of a company called Smith Kline Beecham. And he asked me, do you have any ideas on what we could do? I mean, think of the serendipity. And so by the end of the day, he had talked to Jan Leschly, and we now had albendazole, and that was the beginning of the lymphatic filariasis program, which is terrific. Now, within the last 2 months, we find that by adding one more drug, we may be able to get rid of lymphatic filariasis. It speeds up the whole process to the point that we may be able to eradicate that disease. But you see, I wanted to stop the task force. Mark then took it at that point, and he enlarged it. And what I want to say is that I'm so proud of what Mark and his coalitions have been able to do, because they had a vision that was beyond my view, and they have accomplished things beyond my ability. They are truly rewriting history before it actually happens. And what a great comment that is. So we continue to learn. The good coalitions have certain rules, that the first thing they do is write a picture of what's the last mile. Most coalitions start with what's the next step, but the good ones start with what's the last mile. And they end up figuring out how to substitute individual ego for the team ego, the coalition ego. When football players at the University of Alabama go from their dressing room out to the field, they pass a sign that says, out of yourself and into the team. And that's the story of global health coalitions. Thank you.
when I was telling you how I think Bill thinks, I forgot one important thing. He never forgets anything. Anything. Bill is such an extraordinary leader that Bill Gates chose him to help guide the global health strategy of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the largest foundation in the world. Between 1999 and today, we've witnessed the greatest outflow of generosity ever extended in the field of public health, much of it based on Bill's influence. And when they were considering starting their foundation in the late 1990s, Bill brought to their attention what was then a new concept. He called me up excited and he said, "We've been working on a strategic plan for the foundation, and I've got it. I've been struggling with this. It's been such a hard strategy session." He said, "Not only do I think I've got it, but I've reduced it to the smallest number of words it could be. It's three words." He said, "Global health equity." At the time, the belief that all people, regardless of socioeconomic status, should have access to the means of good health was not widely shared. Bill believed that they should make this a goal for the foundation's work in global health. And taking Bill's injunction, this husband and wife have used their vast resources for the last 15 years to help make global health equity a reality. And as we all know, their impact on the world has been extraordinary. And Bill and Melinda Gates had something they wanted to say to you, Bill, in their own words.
Hello, everyone, and happy 30th birthday to the Task Force for Global Health. What an honor to be asked to pay special tribute to a true giant of the global health community. I'm just so sorry I can't be there, though, in person. We all know of this man's extraordinary achievements. In fact, it's hard to think of an area in public health that he has not improved in some way. But we can sum it up by saying quite simply, millions of people are alive today because of Bill Foege. And with your warmth, charm, vision, and leadership, Bill, you have touched the lives of millions more, including mine. You're my greatest hero in global health. And in fact, this is the picture that sits in my office prominently behind my desk, so I see you most days. And as you well know, Bill, global health is my second career. And ever since I first got involved all those years ago, I've relied heavily on your experience and expertise. And I still do. You're a great advocate, a trusted advisor, and a true friend. And much more than that, though, you've inspired me to be an impatient optimist, to be enthusiastic about what's possible, and to learn from what works and what doesn't, and to be unafraid and unrelenting in taking on some of the biggest challenges. I remember a fascinating and powerful note you wrote to Bill and me just recently. It was about your experience working to save children's lives with vaccines and medicines in the 1980s and 90s, and in particular, the fight against river blindness. And what stood out was how vividly it captured the power of partnerships to improve the life for the world's poorest people. That is something, of course, at the heart of the foundation's work. Your model of collaboration is, I know, still embraced by the Task Force for Global Health today to address a range of challenges. I know, Bill, that you like a good quote, and I thought that this one from the Muslim scholar Abu Bakr was fitting. Without knowledge, action is useless, and knowledge without action is futile. Bill, you embody that attitude. You're not only a great thinker, you're a great doer, and the world owes you a huge debt of gratitude. Have a wonderful celebration.
I remember first meeting Bill Foege, and it was an amazing inspiration right at the time we were trying to figure out what we could do in global health and how ambitious should we be, and was this really the right thing? And he was so helpful in a number of ways. He sent me a lot of books to read, which really helped me out. He still sends me lots of material. I love to get as much as possible. But also, Bill was such an incredible role model, not only for the amazing work he'd done in the field, but for the way he articulated the moral imperative of doing the work. And perhaps most importantly, for his great thinking about the strategy, and in a very egoless way, being behind the organizations that orchestrated the different governments and the different personalities to really come together and take on very ambitious goals. Bill's always very modest, which is partly how he does so much amazing work behind the scenes. But really, the legacy he deserves is that we end these diseases, that we get rid of infectious disease is something that holds back the poor countries. I will start by getting rid of polio. He's given us phenomenal advice on that. We're very close. But then we'll go on. We'll get rid of malaria, TB, HIV, and that will be the fitting legacy for the leadership he's provided. I really want to congratulate and thank everyone who's been involved in the task force. It really drove so many of the things that have happened in the last few decades, and the huge reduction in childhood death. And the way it worked really set the model that will allow global health to have phenomenal success. Bill, thank you for everything you've done.
I'm sure Bill is sitting there thinking, how bad can this get? I do know some of the way he thinks. I would like to now introduce a wonderful friend, Richard Stanley. Richard is a filmmaker, an extraordinary filmmaker who has done great work on advocacy for road traffic safety, for violence prevention, for hunger, for UNICEF, for the World Health Organization. And we convinced Richard to help us with a film about the task force. And I want to introduce Richard to say a few words, and we'll show you his film.
Phew, what a great meeting, and I'm so privileged to be here. Just a brief few words about the film you're about to see. The sheer range and depth of this organization means that trying to document its 30-year history and what it does into 20-odd minutes is, I would say, close to impossible. But essentially what we've tried to do is record the thoughts of some very well-informed, knowledgeable people to give you at least a snapshot of the history and direction of this organization. And in doing so, we've been lucky to be part of a creative, fantastically creative team, including my co-producers Matt and Christine, also our associate producer Paul Olson from the task force, and his assistant, Barbara Ann. And also a special note of the highly talented film teams of Rob Rainey and Don Hooper from here in Atlanta, and Askinda Fasil from Ethiopia, who did a brilliant job in the few days we had there. For the production, we've recorded some great interviews, some of which you're about to see, or parts of, and others which will feature in future productions. Logistics meant we could only film field activities in just one country and just for a very few days, which was Ethiopia. But the brilliant work being carried out there under the direction of Paul Emerson is also representative of many other task force initiatives in other parts of the world. Worth mentioning that one reoccurring theme in all the interviews we recorded, you won't be surprised to hear, is the very deep respect and affection held for Dr. Foege. Every single interview without exception. And his direction and inspiration, along with that of Mark Rosenberg and also now Dave Ross, is, as you know, the magical fuel that fires the task force's work. As an itinerant observer and filmmaker of the last 30 years, I've had the good fortune of meeting and documenting inspiring people like Dr. Foege and also the legendary Jim Grant from UNICEF. But in keeping with Dr. Foege's philosophy, it's really the faces of the individuals and families that I've encountered over the years, many of them featured in this film, which stay with me, which are the driving force of many of the films we put together. I really hope you like the film.
Trachoma is a bacterial disease of the eye, and it has a devastating effect on an individual's family, and on communities. Repeated infections lead to severe trachoma, an incredibly painful and awful way to lose your sight. This sort of project really shows the unique role of the Task Force for Global Health in being a neutral convener, but yet the catalyst that can bring together partners and the very people themselves, bringing them all together in order to achieve something that looks like a miracle, but is actually the result of hard work.
Our work is driven by our values, the value of global health equity, that people everywhere, even the poorest people in the poorest country, should have the equal access to the means of good health.
I think leadership begins with caring. We've had that kind of leadership at the task force. People who really care about health equity, who care about disadvantaged communities and countries, care about children and the health of children. They know what it takes to solve problems.
With polio, we've been hidden for long.
The meeting in Bellagio in 1984 that gave birth to the task force was an extraordinary meeting. And this meeting, it was a huge step forward on the problem of raising childhood immunization rates around the world.
It's almost impossible for me to understand the implications of those 2 days in March of 1984. I mean, how in the world do you get the head of WHO, the head of UNICEF, the head of UNDP, the head of the World Bank, the president of the Rockefeller Foundation, how do you get all of these people to agree to meet on something like immunization? So we could have left there without any agreement at all. And I don't know what would have happened. We still would have had smallpox eradication behind us. But when you look at the speed with which immunization was improving, it was far too slow. And so I don't know what would have happened, but I'm quite pleased with what did happen.
The immunization levels were really stuck at 20%, and it meant that 3,000 children were dying every single day. Children whose lives could be saved if they could raise the immunization rates from 20% to 80%. And the task force was an organization and an approach that got these organizations to work together and to collaborate effectively, and they pulled off a minor miracle.
Everything was changing. It was changing so fast that in 6 years' time, Jim Grant was able to announce that 80% of children had now been reached by at least one vaccine. And at the Summit for Children, September 30th, 1990, he said, "This is the greatest peacetime effort that has ever been made in the world."
Well, the task force began with concerns about immunization rates and using the technology available to prevent vaccine-preventable diseases, largely in Africa. But that extended to the use of life-saving drugs in the drug donation programs with Mectizan and others to prevent and eradicate diseases which can be eliminated from the world.
The headquarters of the Task Force for Global Health in Decatur is a very ordinary looking building, and it wasn't even until 2.5 years ago that we even put our name outside on our building. It really stemmed from Bill Foege's injunction to us. He said, if you want to build successful partnerships, shine the light on your partners and not on yourself.
So we have a very modest and small building here, packed full of people, standing room only, and you wouldn't know by driving past that we coordinate the activities of many thousands of people in the field and provide service to hundreds of millions of people, literally hundreds of millions.
One of the great features of the task force is that it puts its principal resources into program delivery and not into building a major organization top heavy with administrative expense. It is completely dedicated to the delivery of global health services to the most needy around the world.
I think the task force began to flower and emerge to a place where now it's without peer in terms of public health around the world. It occupies such a unique place. Just a remarkable fulcrum between the resources, not only scientific and pharmaceutical resources of this country, and the work in the developing world. I think the genius of Mark in this has been not only to continue the vision that Bill had, and the sense of excellence and scientific credibility, but to bring to it a compassion which established the task force as a credible presence in the developing world. But I've just watched with awe, not just amazement, literally awe, at the way in which this has developed.
When we try to quantify what we do, the numbers are hard to imagine. They're really extraordinary. The number of people who will not be blind because the river blindness was cured or prevented, or they didn't get blinding trachoma. When you think of the numbers of children who can grow up awake and alert because they don't have intestinal parasites, by organizing and collecting data and information, we now have the capability to understand the problems of the poorest and the most vulnerable. To know that we're contributing to that improvement by our programs, both over the history of the task force and even just the programs that we're doing today, it's an extraordinary privilege.
Definitely, this is training people in the field, in the job, to do the epidemiology investigation. Now, definitely, is more than 62 programs around the world with about 85 countries involved in this network.
Intestinal worms are one of the most common widespread infections in humans. There's estimated to be more than 1 billion people infected and some 800 million children who are at risk of infection. There's a magic in the air when you get people together focusing on solving a problem that affects the health and development of millions of people.
I think the task force has had a focus since its inception on developing collaborations. And I think it was that focus that was one of the reasons why the drug donation programs developed the relationship they have with the task force. And it is the drug donation programs that are really the major drivers of the neglected tropical disease programs. Without those donations, the programs simply wouldn't go.
Since we're talking about billions of people with the infections that have to be targeted, there are many challenges in delivering the medication that has been donated. And the problems that arise are then shifted to those operational research teams, and a lot of that is coordinated from here at the NTD Support Center.
The task force, we're approving over $1 billion worth of drugs every year, donated. And actually, Mass Drug Administration is now seen as a sort of standard tool for hitting the diseases that affect what we often call the bottom billion. Mostly the poorest populations, mostly the populations with no political voice, no economic voice. These are the people who need the drugs most, and we have over a period of time developed systems of getting drugs for Mass Drug Administration to those very remote communities.
Trachoma is one of the diseases that the task force works on. They're characterized, these neglected diseases and the vaccine preventable diseases, they're characterized by really now affecting people who live in the faraway corners of the world. beyond the end of the road, living a life often forgotten about and without hope. Not all of our partners and not all of the people we collaborate with have the ability to come here, and it's a commitment. It's not easy to actually get out here. And for me, it's a personal privilege. With trachoma and with the other neglected diseases, we don't have to wait for anything. We're not waiting for a vaccine. We're not waiting for a new technology. We know what to do. We know how to do it. We know where to do it. The issue now is getting together in partnership to bring the resources, the donated drugs, the human infrastructure, the volunteers who do all the work on the front line, to bring them all together, and we can consign diseases like this to the wastebasket of history. It can be done. We can get rid of these things, and conditions that have tormented humanity throughout history can themselves become history.
As a child, my friends and I were all victims of trachoma. The suffering was terrible. When I became a health worker, I could bring the intervention program to my village. I look at this beautiful girl. Her eyes are clear. She's free of this disease. The children are not suffering as we used to suffer.
I see a much, much more expanded and more important role for the task force going into the future. As more and more organizations, more and more foundations, more and more businesses enter the field of global health, there's more and more need to bring them together, to get them to collaborate effectively, and to take what is a very dispersed business and to get it to be convergent. That's exactly what the task force does. That's exactly what's going to be needed more and more into the future. I think we can have a bigger and bigger impact.
I think for Pfizer and the task force, one of the things that was really important about the task force's contribution for us was that they really brought other players to the table. Pfizer had started the ITI as an independent nonprofit, and we decided to house it at the task force, and really at that point we're able to take the program to scale. And I think that could be very much attributed to the tenets that the task force supports around partnership, around believing in the possible, around breaking down barriers.
Going back to 1984, the origin of the task force was all around increasing immunizations in Africa. They actually achieved their goal by the end of 1990. The task force then went on to do other things in pharmacophilanthropy and public health informatics and healthcare strengthening, but they wanted to come back to their roots, and so that was the origin of starting the Center for Vaccine Equity.
So when we met in March of 1984, the coverage for immunization was very poor. For measles, it may have been as low as 10% of the children of the world, and measles was the single most lethal agent in the world. It was killing over 3 million children a year. I mean, an incredible toll. And when you think of 3 million couples having dinner at night missing a child, then you start understanding what this actually means. It's not 3 million children, it's 3 million families that are suffering.
Well, immunizations in many ways can be the leading edge for achieving health equity. Immunizations are simple to deliver. They are widely recognized as important. They have visible and dramatic impact. We're involved in several different projects, including supporting the endgame strategy for polio eradication, which includes introducing inactivated polio vaccine in all countries in the world where it's not being used currently, and next year a switch in the types of oral polio vaccine that we'll be using.
The switch itself is not really unique. We've switched from one medical product to another worldwide. The unique part of this is the whole world has to switch at the same time, simultaneously. You can imagine how difficult that is. I can barely get my three kids to line up in a line on any given day, much less 156 countries and nations and regions with their own politics and priorities. The meeting itself that we had at the Task Force for Global Health was to bring partners, workers, scientists, as well as logisticians and program managers, bring them all into our room to explain this to them, to give them the rationale, give them the appropriate tools to help facilitate the switch so that they can take these materials and then implement them in their own countries as well as their neighboring countries.
The advantages of working with the task force is that you're working with a group of people who are experts, bringing together, you know, as taking place this week, a training involving 60 people from 30 different countries. They're able to kind of almost miraculously bring together content, meetings, and do that with a very diverse group of partners, whether it's geographically diverse or in terms of the organizations that they represent, and be able to just quickly make things happen.
For me, one of the strengths of the task force is the staff. The individuals that we have here at the task force, they're mission driven. They have been in search of a place to apply their skills, their knowledge, and this passion for global health, and a journey to make an impact in the lives of others.
I've stood in hospital settings in developing countries and watched babies dying by literally several per hour. What I came to learn was just frightening, that in this hospital setting, they had a 40% mortality rate of children within the first 24 hours of admission. So in the course of a 1 hour meeting in the pediatric ward, standing there with health professionals, we're watching babies die. I had colleagues, these are doctors, leave crying. They couldn't take it. It's like, this is an outrage. And I think so finding where you can do something that's actually productive has been one of the challenges, but we've worked at trying to keep those faces and those problems in mind and take action.
One of the key areas is determining what are the causes of child death in poor countries around the world, and what can be done to alleviate those deaths. We think that many of them are preventable, and the total is somewhere between 6.5 and 7 million deaths in children that are potentially preventable. A key element of that is an informatics system of organizing data, of getting the information you need, making it easy to analyze and interpret and share with other people. And that's an area in which the task force has excelled with its Public Health Informatics Institute.
The Public Health Informatics Institute has always talked about information management. It's not the old public health style of simply collecting lots of data and keeping it in siloed databases and looking at it annually. That doesn't work in the 21st century. And the Public Health Informatics Institute has really been a catalyst for thinking about information management. How do you use that information? What's the point of collecting this information? How are you going to use it to make people's health better?
A new Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation funded initiative called CHAMPS, which is the Child Health and Mortality Prevention Surveillance Network. It's a major initiative of the Gates Foundation, and this initiative is aimed at going to those places in greatest need of the highest infant mortality and changing it. But it's probably one of the most significant global health initiatives in our lifetime. This is very, very important. This is at least a 20-year initiative. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is willing to put the support needed over a long period of time to actually determine why kids are dying, and then using that information to come up with interventions that changes it. And then once changed, to do it in a way that change remains.
For a long time, people differentiated global health from domestic health. So people in the United States thought that global health just meant health of people in other countries. But we think we can learn lots of lessons from global health and bring those lessons home. Lessons that would benefit us as we try to improve our own healthcare system. We're part of the world. We have a lot to learn from the world, and global health has a lot to teach us.
Because we're now seeing that even in the poorest countries in the developing world, diseases that are not infectious are becoming more and more important as causes of death.
Chronic health problems like diabetes and obesity and heart disease, that where the mortality is enormous in the developing world and where the line is flattening in the more economically developed countries, that this upward curve is going to be a major problem. So we have started to tease out those questions.
Fortunately, the past 30 years has brought to the task force core capabilities that are needed for us to take the next step forward. We know we're going to move into non-communicable diseases. Non-communicable diseases are problems that require cross-sectoral collaboration. Again, the task force, because of our history at bringing people together, acting as a convener, acting as a group that helps crystallize an understanding of a problem and coalesce action, that's really the right formula for tackling and making progress with them.
I would certainly not say it's any coincidence that the task force is located here in greater Atlanta. The fact that we are finding ways to create alliances, to create cooperative agreements and arrangements in order to tackle issues that are plaguing not only the world, but even more locally, plaguing our country and our communities.
Well, I think the fact that the task force is located here in Atlanta also gives it a special advantage. You know, Atlanta is a city that for many, many decades has demonstrated how different groups coming together can really accomplish great things. If you think about what happened with the civil rights movement, what's happening now in global health, and the task force, you know, I think in some ways has benefited from that heritage, but it's also contributed a lot to that heritage.
So we have a very rich city that has many resources, and the task force is really helping to bring all of these organizations together to work on global health issues.
My interest in the task force has been stimulated again by my contact with Mark Rosenberg, who is one of my heroes, and who has the capacity for having people see problems beyond just the numbers and having people see problems in terms of the faces. The whole issue of compassion in public health, not moralizing about public health, but the extent to which compassion is such an integral part of what people do in public health.
Well, I think compassion is really a key foundation of the task force, the desire to really make a difference in the lives of people, a meaningful difference in their health, in their environment in which they live in, and their ability to provide for themselves.
I think the task force does an incredible job of making sure that we never forget the faces behind those numbers, and that we carry that in our hearts and in our minds as we go about doing the work that we do.
These are very good examples, living examples, good evidences where we have seen, we have witnessed, you know, the communities can really change and they can transform their own lives and their children's future as well.
I can't begin to describe the impact of the work. When you see the faces of children, when you go into the villages and hear the stories from the parents, the community, it's really breathtaking.
The results of this entire effort are so mind-boggling that even though I've been watching global health for 65 years, I continue to get enthusiastic just seeing what's happening. It used to be that we lost 50,000 children under the age of 5 every day in the world. I mean, imagine that. We're down to about 16,000, a third, in my lifetime. That's still far too many. It's obscene to have to lose that number of children. But when you see the improvement, it takes defining your last mile before you do anything else. Because gradually the things you thought could not be done are being done. I grew up with the phrase, seeing is believing, only to find that was backwards. Believing is seeing. If you believe in something, you are going to be able to see it. Because now you have a vision of what does that last mile look like.
I want to thank Richard. I think a lot of films are made in prose, but I think what Richard does is written in poetry. Thank you, Richard. I'd like to now welcome our live webcast audience who are tuning in for the panel discussion that will start shortly. The discussion topic is what it will take to end diseases of extreme poverty. And I do want to say that this is a very special day for me. First, it's a take my wife to work day. She doesn't usually come, and she's the most important person in my life. But it's also a day when two other incredibly important people in my life are here. The great American writer Philip Roth wrote about himself and his mentor. He said, "I'll put the matter in plain language as directly as I can. I believe we fell in love with each other." Reading these words and thinking about it many times over, I realize I too have been fortunate to also fall in love with two mentors, and I need to say what a rare and truly wonderful thing it is to have Bill Foege and Howard Hyatt in my life. To help me introduce this panel, I would like first to welcome Howard Hyatt, a mentor, a colleague, a friend, who taught me about a value that we're celebrating here this morning, global health equity. Dr. Hyatt has been a champion of global health equity for his entire career. He's the former dean of the Harvard School of Public Health and co-founded the Division of Global Health Equity at Brigham and Women's Hospital, where he still serves as associate chief. Howard has been a mentor to me and also to Paul Farmer and to Jim Kim. And before we start our panel discussion, I'd like to ask Howard to say a few words about our panel and why ending diseases of extreme poverty should matter to us here in this room and in this country.
If I offer advice to people in this audience, advice that when you look for people as friends, you find people like Mark, that advice could not be better. How gifted I am to be able to claim Mark as a friend. And here, celebrating the work of the task force has special meaning for me because I have seen up close the growth of the field of global health for most of the 30 years of the task force existence. What was once a small but passionate group of physicians with some new ideas about achieving high quality medical care in impoverished and remote areas of the world has become a cause, a new movement that has attracted in our country, a new movement that has attracted many of our best young people. And my privilege today to comment briefly on the heroes of this field of global health is one you can understand. Mark will talk more about the specifics of each of the people on the panel, but I just want to say a few words about each of the members. One person on the panel who conceptualized and oversaw the worldwide program you've already heard about, and what a contribution he has made to our society, to our world. There, in addition, on the panel is a person who decided at an early age that his goal was, in the words of the author Tracy Kidder, to cure the world, well before he took his MD and PhD in anthropology at Harvard. He began working with people in Haiti. And returning there as a physician, he undertook to treat people with tuberculosis and AIDS and many of the other diseases you've heard about, you've mentioned today. He co-founded a group that subsequently spread its practices to many other areas around the world where impoverished people lack health care. With his colleagues, he introduced a new model for medical care where resources were severely limited. More recently, he has started a university, including a medical school, in a country in Africa. You will hear from another panelist, another physician anthropologist, who decided that policy was where he would focus his attention. He believed that the failure of the World Health Organization in the last part of the last century, in the early part of this, to treat African people with AIDS was unacceptable. And in 2003, he took leave from Harvard to go to the World Health Organization and find the funding to launch a program for treatment in Africa that was called 3x5. That is, by 2005, 3 million people with AIDS in Africa would be in treatment. His was the first program to take what was always understood to be a virtually unachievable aspiration and inspiration and to make it happen. Now he has set a goal for the World Bank of eliminating extreme poverty by 2030. In addition, we'll hear from a person who has been a leader in the World Health Organization as well as within her own country. She has made major contributions in a range of health fields, but particularly in HIV/AIDS. She is the first woman to be elected director of the African Regional Office of WHO. She is committed to save people of the African nations, to help them achieve universal health care coverage and the improvements that prevention can bring. And as you've heard Mark mention, the application of lessons that we've learned from much of the health care work you'll hear more about in developing countries, and the adoption of some of those practices in our own will bring enormous benefit to a healthcare system that is urgently in need of benefit, that is, our own. And I won't say further about Mark other than to underline my privilege to have known him throughout his career since he was a medical student, and to find myself now the benefit of his generosity in permitting me to appear on this program. Warwick?
Well, let me welcome the panelists up onto the stage and ask them to take a seat here. Jim, Paul, Seedy, Bill. And I should say when they're coming up, this is a reunion of sorts, an extraordinary reunion, an important one with Jim and Paul. And it's been a privilege to see them grow and develop from when we first started working on a project MDR-TB together. When we started working, they were described by Howard to me as two young students I needed to meet because they were going to be the Pied Pipers of global health.
So now I change positions, and they're grown up legitimate stars in their own right. And it's a pleasure to welcome them here, Jim, Paul, Seedy, and Bill. There are a lot of firsts on this stage, and I just want to call these to your attention. So Jim is the first physician ever to be president of the World Bank. And Jim has devoted his career to the advancement of underserved populations across the globe. As the director of the World Health Organization's HIV-TB department, Jim brought life-saving treatment to millions. He saw that global health was good at writing guidelines and setting norms, and doing research and writing strategic plans, but global health was terrible. I don't think those were the exact words you used. Something like that. Global health was really terrible, though, at delivering the goods to the people who needed them. So Jim came back and started a program at Harvard in global health delivery that's gone on to be extraordinarily valuable in this world. I should say, Jim didn't start out intending to become the president of the World Bank, I don't think.
Yeah, he did.
Jim and Paul used to rail, again, I won't use the words they used, against this very institution because it was so slow to respond and sometimes a little bit misguided in what it did.
We didn't just rail, Mark. We tried to shut it down, actually.
There you go. How people change, how we gain perspective and develop as we grow up. Are you still trying to shut it down?
Well, I'm glad we lost that fight, that particular fight. 50 years is enough. We were part of the 50 years is enough campaign. 20 years ago, we thought that it was time to shut the World Bank Group down.
And now fixing it goes with fixing the world. Jim was the quarterback for his high school football team. And I don't know if that's where you developed this attitude, but it's an incredible can-do attitude. The attitude that these two young physicians could take on the World Bank and shut it down. But I think Jim's attitude is very much like optimism, a quality that Bill has taught me to value. It's optimism on steroids.
We lost every game my senior year, Mark, so it was...
So you needed the optimism.
Optimism born of adversity, yeah.
Jim and Paul founded Partners in Health together, and I started working with them when they were working on a project in Caraballo, Peru, a little shanty town outside of Lima. And they found out that a lot of people there had TB, but it was TB that wouldn't respond to the usual TB drugs. It was multiply resistant MDR-TB. It's very hard to treat, and it takes treatment with 7 or 8 different drugs, each with a highly toxic side effect at the same time, and not for 6 months like regular TB, but taking combinations of these highly toxic drugs for 24 months, 2 years. And they had seen that in New York City, there had been an outbreak of MDR-TB, and it cost to treat those patients $200,000 a person for successful treatment. They'd been hospitalized, treated for a long time, and declared cured, but the costs were so high that the World Health Organization said, we can't afford to treat poor people in poor countries if they have MDR-TB, because it takes away from resources we need for treating people with non-resistant TB and other diseases. So if a poor person in a poor country gets MDR-TB, the policy of the World Health Organization is we just have to let them die. And as you might guess, this was totally unacceptable to Paul and to Jim. And so they figured out how to get drugs down to Lima, Peru, and to Caraballo. They went to the hospital pharmacy. Now, this pharmacy at the Brigham and Women's Hospital, you have to understand, was set up to provide drugs for house officers whose kid might have an ear infection. And sometimes these house officers would run up a bill, maybe $25 that they hadn't paid. And one day, while Jim and Paul were taking suitcases full of these very expensive medicines down with them on each trip to Lima, one day Howard Hyatt got a call from the head of medicine who said, Howard, your boys have got to stop. Their bill is now $50,000.
$50,000.
Howard pleaded on your behalf, and he got the hospital to agree to let you keep taking some drugs. But then, as Jim said, it ran up to $97,000, approaching $100,000, and the hospital was going to shut them down. You called me, and you said, we need a grant. We need a grant for about $1 million, and I think that will get us through. We can keep our successful program going long enough to show the world that it works. Well, I thought $1 million was a lot of money to get for the Pied Pipers, but we had a meeting with Bill at the task force, and Bill came, Paul and Jim made their case, and at that time, Bill was working with the Gates Foundation, and we worked for about a year, and during that year, back and forth, finally, we got a grant, and the grant was the largest grant that the Gates Foundation had ever given for MDR-TB. It was for $44.5 million. And this began the Partners TB program in Peru. It was an extraordinary program.
Can I add a note?
Sure.
When this grant proposal went to Bill Gates, he sent it back to me and said, aren't they padding the budget? And so, which they were, but what... But I sent him a copy of the New Yorker magazine that talked about Paul had only one suit, and it was a black suit because he tended to get ink stains on it. And I said, people with one suit don't usually pad the budget. And he approved it.
Friends in high places sometimes make all the difference. Sidi Moedi is another first. Sidi is the first woman ever to be chosen by the African states to head the World Health Organization in Africa. Sidi is a public health official who had two extraordinarily distinguished physicians as parents. And she joined the WHO Regional Office for Africa in 1999 and has had several senior positions already in WHO. And she worked with Jim on the HIV/AIDS epidemic. Dr. Moedi led part of Jim's initiative, the 3x5 initiative for WHO for the African region, and helped establish the systems for giving out the antiretrovirals to treat people and save their lives from HIV/AIDS. Their work together was extraordinary. They didn't reach 3 million people in 5 years, but they got half that far, and they did an extraordinary change about for WHO. WHO actually got out there, delivered the goods, and made a huge change in the lives of many, many people. And before joining WHO, Dr. Moeti was a leader for Africa and the Middle Eastern desk for UNAIDS in Geneva and a regional advisor for UNICEF. And she's from Botswana, and she's served in several positions for the Ministry of Health there. And in her new role, she has committed to work with transparency, something extraordinarily valuable and important in Africa, efficiency and equity. And she's committed to bring universal healthcare coverage to Africa. And she brings hope and understanding to the health issues that face the people of Africa in a new and very, very exciting way. And Paul has talked about accompaniment, an extraordinary idea. And Sidi is here. I think it's no small chance that she's accompanying us in talking about this. She needs to be part of this, and we're delighted to have you here, Sidi. Thank you.
Thank you.
Paul is the chief strategist and the founder of Partners in Health. And with Jim, he worked on that project for MDR-TB, also had worked for years, probably 30 years now, in Haiti, bringing healthcare to the poorest of the poor. He went on to become a university professor at Harvard. It's the highest distinguished rank that Harvard can bestow on anyone. He's also the chair of the Department of Global Health and Social Medicine at Harvard Medical School, chief of the Division of Global Health Equity at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. And so that Jim doesn't get jealous about Paul's academic feats, Jim also held some of those same chairs and then went on to be president of Dartmouth University. Paul also serves, we talk about those institutions against which people railed. He serves as the United Nations Special Advisor to the Secretary General on Community-Based Medicine and Lessons from Haiti, and was a Special Advisor with Bill Clinton on cholera in Haiti. He has written extensively about health and human rights, the role of social inequalities, and the distribution and outcome of infectious diseases in global health. Paul also has achieved an extraordinary first. Recently, President Bill Clinton awarded you a Lifetime Distinguished Achievement Award from the Forbes 400. And this gathering was quite impressive. It was a gathering of billionaires in New York to give this award to Paul. And President Clinton said during this ceremony, he said, if there was a Nobel Prize for being a world-class human being, Paul Farmer would have won it a long time ago. And like Pope Francis, Paul has a message that appeals both to billionaires and to the poorest people at the same time. Paul has espoused liberation theology. And liberation theology, Paul taught me, has two parts. And it says, if you want to work for social justice and do good on the earth, you have to help those who are least able to help themselves. Am I more or less right? The second part, though, is to really help those least able to care for themselves. You need to know them, and you need to live among them to know them. And Paul has done both of this. He is the subject of Tracy Kidder's book, Mountain Beyond Mountains. And I should add that when Paul and Jim took on this challenge of showing that you could treat MDR-TB among poor people in poor countries, they were successful. They showed that you could do it not for $200,000 a case, but for less than $2,000 a case. And on that basis, the World Health Organization changed their policy. And they said, whoever gets MDR-TB, wherever they live, whether they're rich or poor, those people should be treated. Bill, you're the last person I have to introduce. And Bill asked me to do him two favors today. He said, make the introduction short, and he said, and that I agreed to do. And the second part was,
it's too late.
I meant the introduction for this panel discussion.
And the second request was to steer the focus away from the old man and keep it on the young people. And that I can't do completely, because I think something that's so very important is the intergenerational transmission of knowledge. It's something you have invested deeply in, you and Howard have invested in. As now, as these three younger people become the leading generation, I think it's important to contribute to that. So I'm delighted that you're here and participating in this. Let me start with a question to you, Jim. You announced last week, Jim was just in Lima, Peru, and it was a triumphant return to Caraballo, where he had been going on these midnight trips, taking medicines in a suitcase to help cure the people there. This was a return trip to Caraballo, now as the president of the World Bank. And you announced that for the first time, the percentage of people living in poverty, in extreme poverty around the world, will likely fall to under 10% this year. And you said, this is the best story in the world. It's a wonderful story. Talk to us about why that was important to you and a little bit about what's the connection between poverty and some of these diseases.
Well, you know, over the past 15 years, the drop in the number of people living in extreme poverty has been extremely rapid. But still, there's probably now, we don't know exactly because there's not a household survey from this year, but probably about 700 million people living in poverty. But by 2020, half of those will be in fragile and conflict-affected states. And then by 2030, 90% will be there. So it's been great, but it's mostly been driven by, frankly, high rates of economic growth in China. China lifted 600 million people out of poverty in that period, and there's no country in the world that's done that so quickly. So now it's sort of like we couldn't have imagined in 25 years ago when almost half the population was living in extreme poverty, this notion that the poor you shall always have with you was sort of what we had thought. And so the excitement is that we now are the first generation in human history that can see the end of extreme poverty. Now, I have to go back and talk about Bill a little bit. So,
you don't have to.
I do. So, first of all, I just want to say that and I can say this with all honesty. I would not be here today without the support of Bill Foege. That $44.5 million grant was absolutely transformative for us. I mean, there's just and there's no way, I think, that the Gates Foundation would have considered giving it to us if Bill hadn't been there and Mark hadn't made the connection. The way I think about just about everything is affected by what the stories I heard from Bill, especially about the 1984 meeting and about what it meant to set a goal. The 3x5 goal. Gro Harlem Brundtland had just announced that in a paper in a discussion that, well, you know, if there's treatment, we should probably try to get half of all people on treatment. This was in 2001. And, knowing as we do what setting a clear target with a clear end date does for you, and we learned that really from the child survival revolution, I suggested to J.W. Lee at the time that we set a target. And it was extremely controversial because it wasn't 5 years, Mark. We were going to set the target in 2003, so there'd be 2.5 years left. To go from about 50,000 to 3 million was the most outrageous target anyone could have ever imagined. But the importance of a target is that it forced you to change the way you do your work. And the reason JW allowed us to do it, because he remembered what it was like during the child survival revolution. He said, before that target, before we were clear that we wanted to get to 80%, we were all fighting each other, right? And he said, he brought the HIV team together at WHO, which was notoriously rancorous. And he said to them, the reason we set this target, he said, is because I know what it was like. You know, the immunization people were running all over the place, fighting each other. But then when we got the target, no matter how much we hated each other, we focused, because we had every day we were counting. And so he said, that's why I agreed to 3x5. Because you guys before, it was these three who hated these five and those five who hated these three. Now you have 3x5. Get to work. So everything we've done has been affected by that. The reason, you know, we had something on our wall that's at the bank that said, our dream is a world free of poverty. And I said, so when is it going to stop being a dream? And I don't think anyone at the bank understood what I was doing when I got the board to agree to a target of ending extreme poverty by 2030. And everyone said, ah, well, of course, it's so far away. We got plenty of time. And when we established that target, every day I could go back and say, okay, so what are you doing to reach that target? Now, this has been played on me a lot. Now, so one day, a group came up to me, you know, and they said, hey, Jim, 2.5 billion people in the world don't have access to financial services. They don't have a bank account. They can't get small loans. They're literally sticking their money under the mattress. Poor farmers spend all their money too early because they don't have a bank account. And by the time school decisions come, they run out of money because the harvest isn't in yet. We're going to give everybody a bank account. And I said, well, by when? They said, we can do it by 2020. So I said, really? Okay. The Queen of the Netherlands, who was a former finance person, she and I were on a panel, and they said, just announce it at the panel. And the Queen looked at me and said, Jim, are you sure about this? I said, that's what my team tells me. And so I went out there and I said, we're going to have universal access to financial services, everyone in the world by 2020. And then after the meeting, I came back and I said, okay, so what's the plan? And they said, we don't have a plan. And I said, so why did you make me do, oh, we know you love targets and you love end dates. So I said, okay, tomorrow I want you to set up a war room. I want you to have dedicated people doing it and give me a plan for universal access to financial services. And after about a year, they came up with one. And last year, we were able to announce that we think we can get 1 billion people access to financial services. MasterCard and Visa said, and we'll take 500 million each, right? So everything I do, Bill, everything I do is impacted by your career. And also, whenever I give advice, I always tell Bill Foege stories. And so one of the great lines that you've heard many, many times is that no one will follow the call of an uncertain trumpet. That's a great one. But my favorite one is actually from Bill's wife. So Bill, I forget when it was, Bill, but you said that you learned so many lessons from your wife, who was a kindergarten teacher. She walked into the class one day, the first day of class, and she said to the kindergartners, okay, now if anybody needs to go to the bathroom, raise your hand. And one boy raised his hand quickly and said, how does that help? So every time we are in a meeting, I tell that story, and I say, everyone just raise your hand and ask yourself, how does that help?
Do you ever wake up in the morning scared that maybe you're not going to be able to reach these targets?
Well, you know, one of the things we learned, CD and I learned this together, we didn't reach the target, but we went from 50,000, and in 2.5 years, we got to 1.1 million, right? And everyone said, oh my God, it's the most amazing thing that's ever happened. And there is a real key. The real key was every 6 months we counted. And we didn't have perfect data, but we had better data than anyone else. And because every 6 months I'd have a press conference and say, you know, wow, Zambia's moving. Botswana has been moving. What's going on in Nigeria and India? That peer pressure had a huge impact. And you know, and back in those days, it's hard to recall, and CD remember, how unsure people were that this was a good idea. And we kept saying, but you know, if you get your viral load down to zero, isn't that going to have some preventive effect? You know, what we know now, and you know, Paul and CD know more than I do about this, but it's one of the only things that have worked in terms of prevention. So setting a target and counting is really critical. And that's why we're going from counting poverty only every 3 years with two-year-old data. We're gonna now do it every single year. You've got to have rhythm and pace. People have to know, and that we're holding them accountable. And if you do that, whether you succeed or fail really doesn't matter in my mind. I mean, and CD will remember July of 2005.
we knew that we weren't going to get there. And I always told the team, because the team was so scared, when we started the 3x5, everybody goes, this is terrible, this is so much pressure. And they said, why are you so worried about it? And they said, well, what if we fail? I said, well, what if we fail? And they said, we'll be blamed. And I said, is that all? That's what you're worried about? So I said, you know what? I'll take the blame. I will take 100% of the blame. And I actually did in July of 2005. Right? And by that time, the team was so into it that when I came back, I was on the BBC. I said, you know, they kept saying to me, Dr. Kim, what do you say to those people who are not receiving treatment? And he asked me that question about 15 times, which is what good journalists will do. And I finally said, you know, all we can do is apologize. We didn't work quickly enough. We could have done more. We delayed too early. All we can do is apologize. And then the headline, WHO apologizes for failure of treatment, right? And when I went back, the team then had been transformed, and they were angry at me for having apologized. Because they said, we should never apologize. Look at what happened, 1.1 million people on treatment. And so they were so angry at me. But then I started getting emails. They were saying, wow, Jim, brilliant move, right? Apologize first so they can't criticize you for failing, right? It wasn't planned, but I learned something really important. And the thing is, if you do not set high, high ambitions, people won't change the way they work. So ending poverty by 2030 is changing the way we and a lot of people work.
Well, thanks, Jim. I think we're lucky to have you there. I just hope you stay in office until 2030 to make sure we do it. It will change the world. Sidi, you are coming in to lead AFRO at an amazing time. And there are now sustainable development goals that set out some of these targets for you. What do you see as your biggest challenge going forward as you try to lead that nation to success in these goals?
I think, well, first of all, I'd just like to say to Jim what an inspiration it was. And I think it's relevant for the Sustainable Development Goals. For me, as a physician who'd worked in Botswana on HIV/AIDS, and this was one of the, at one point, my country was the epicenter of the global HIV/AIDS epidemic. And I left Botswana very exhausted to join UNICEF, feeling guilty as well, but thinking, no, I need to do something else with my life, and came back to HIV/AIDS working in UNAIDS. And when this ambitious and some thought crazy target was set, it was to me such a personal inspiration out of the despair, because there'd been real despair among physicians, nurses, healthcare workers, and leaders working on HIV/AIDS in African countries, myself included. I often asked myself, what am I doing here if it's not leading to people having hope? So what it did, in addition to the practical work of struggling to put all those people in treatment, it inspired, it transformed entirely the prospects and thinking about HIV/AIDS in Africa at one of its lowest moments. So I think that that was the biggest value for me as an individual. And I remember going home and telling my husband and children that, oh, you'll have to forgive me for a year or so. I'm going to neglect you, and I just want us to agree that this is okay, because I've just received news that will make my work worth doing, which it has felt very difficult working in HIV/AIDS in Africa for a number of years. So I think that the Sustainable Development Goals inspire us in a similar way. There was a lot of work done by African countries, by health stakeholders in the African region to move the Millennium Development Goals. And we did make a lot of progress. Countries reduced child mortality, maternal mortality to some extent. I think if you look at the summary of what happened about the Millennium Development Goals, there were some significant achievements in African countries, even if they did not reach all the targets. But I think what we started to learn as we were bumping up against the last constraints was that there are certain things that need attention: equity, justice, inclusiveness, dealing with everybody, and paying particular attention to these, not hoping that by accident, if we're enlarging and scaling up services, then those people who have the biggest gaps in terms of health improvement, health status, things will trickle down to them and their health will improve as well. I think we've learned that we need to be, in a conscious way, targeting this equity, targeting justice, and using science and data to find out who are the people who are most marginalized, and setting the types of policies for financing, for strategies, for health in countries that will make sure that those people are not left behind. That is one thing that encourages me in the way that the Sustainable Development Goals have been framed. And as we all know, it was a long fight, and it was a big, long negotiation to arrive at some of these. But I'm glad that we are using some of the lessons that we've learned struggling with what we saw as injustice. I think the absolute injustice of the fact that if you happened to be born in an African country which could not afford to pay the high levels of prices for HIV/AIDS drugs, you were condemned to die of HIV. It really makes equity, justice, inclusiveness very important and very promising principles for me as part of these goals. In addition to that, we've had to learn and be humbled. And I think that the HIV experience was a very painful lesson in terms of taking a multi-sectoral approach to health. And perhaps Jim might agree, and Paul as well, that many of the attempts that were made to deal with prevention of HIV, assuming that if every sector puts HIV in its policy, in its strategies, we will get women educated, we will get girls protected, we will get people's circumstances changed so that they don't have to put themselves at risk in order to eat and therefore risk getting HIV. That largely did not succeed very well. So in my view, some of the lessons that we've learned there and the fundamental agreement that's been made to address multisectoral action, work together with other sectors, and I acknowledge that in the health sector, we humbly have to acknowledge we have much to learn here. When I talk to my staff who work on the social developments, social determinants of health, they often tell me that, oh, we need committees. We need multisectoral committees. And I just glaze over and say to them, no, we need something more than committees. But clearly, we have to learn. And I believe we do have lessons of how to work on education, how to address determinants like water and sanitation that are contributing to mortality among poor people, that really are offering us big opportunities in the Sustainable Development Goals. These are some of the challenges that we are facing, but I believe that we have learned a lot that will help countries to move on these goals.
Well, thanks, Sidi. And I think you're right. We need to be thinking about poor people if we're going to eliminate these diseases of extreme poverty. This is something you've been dealing with, Paul, for years and years. What are the challenges in getting the rest of the world to focus on the problems of poor people? And what are some of the lessons you've learned about that?
Well, first of all, I would just want to say that, I've been working with Jim for 30 years. So sometimes it's hard for me to see where, you know, one way of seeing things ends and the other begins. And that's the... You know, that of course is the notion behind partnership in general. It's why we call it Partners in Health. It's why Bill and others have used this form of attacking significant social problems. It's not just forming a task force or a multi-sectoral approach. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more than that. It's understanding when we get stuck because we're so socialized for scarcity that we can't do what Bill just said, which is believing is seeing. And I would just add that that's been one of the great things about working with Jim is because he's actually always been able to see things, see around corners, and imagine a world in which we don't need to be socialized for scarcity. So I would say that's the biggest problem, is that we have this profound failure of imagination, and that gets beaten into us either by working in situations of great privation, or we actually extend that notion of privation to others but not ourselves. So we can easily imagine dropping, you know, I just dropped my daughter off at a very fine university not too far from here, but we somehow, for in education among the poor, we don't think of tertiary education, we think of primary education. And I was just reading something Jim wrote thinking about tuberculosis, you know, the idea of selective primary health care, as Bill will remember, as laid out by the way, colleagues of ours from Harvard in the 80s, didn't even include any kind of a treatment for tuberculosis, whether susceptible or resistant. And you know, the first time you heard that, you'd say, really? That's how socialization for scarcity operates? It keeps on knocking interventions off the list. Mm-hmm. You mentioned leukemia in children. We just talked about AIDS. We've talked about hard to treat or expensive to treat tuberculosis. The list goes on and on. And moving back, it included getting vaccination rates above 20% to 80%. So the lesson about the big challenge, I think, is really about failure of imagination and about being so socialized for scarcity with no excuse, because we don't live in scarcity, but really on behalf of others, that it damages our approach to these pressing problems. And that's why when Bill came up with those three words, it sounded like music to us, if global I may, equity. Global health equity, because it doesn't allow you to fall into a trap. The trap of cost effectiveness is not that it's a dumb idea, it's that people don't know how to assess either cost or effectiveness. So it's empirically dumb, right? Until you say, well, wait, what's the difference between cost and price? Or how do we know that's effective? What is that, the right metric? So the fetishization, sorry, we both have, you know, PhDs in anthropology, which ended up being a good thing sometimes, but not so good at other times. The reification of a particular approach or a model, whether it's called primary health care, selective primary health care, you know, a metric, a way of measuring something, you know, it's good until it's not good, right? It's useful until it's not useful. If you can stick with, and I'm just, you know, repeating what you said, if you can stick with notions like equity, justice, you know, high targets, you know, that was astounding to me, being on the phone with Jim when he was at the WHO. I mean, if he could have seen me on the other end of the line, of course, Jim wanted to put in one of those fancy, you know, you can, looks like something out of a spy movie, where he would have seen me going, what? Their main worry is that they will take the blame. Well, what about all the people who are going to die? Isn't that a consideration? I didn't say that, but I realize that here are people of goodwill. Okay, I did, but I didn't say it publicly. These are people of goodwill. I mean, our peers, our brethren and sistren, who are internalizing something other than a concern for equity, justice, fairness. You know, go ahead.
So the big thing, it's not just the cost and effectiveness. The question that global health people have been terrible at asking is, well, what's actually the denominator? Right? Mm. So what's the share of the pie? So 3.5 years now as a banker, I've just like, oh my God, why didn't I understand how this stuff works before? Because the Sustainable Development Goals are 17 goals, 169 targets, and what the Secretary General did 2 years ago was he came to us, you know, we meet all the multilateral development banks, the Inter-American Development Bank, European Investment Bank, EBRD, all of us, and the IMF, we meet probably 3 or 4 times a year. And he came to a meeting and he said, 2 years before the SDGs, he said, I want you to come up with a plan for financing. And so we started saying, well, so then what is the cost of 17 goals and 169 targets? Easily trillions of dollars a year. So Paul and I remember very well when Jeff Sachs used to say, stop using the M word and use the B word. Mm-hmm. So we just said, well, why don't we stop using the B word and use the T word? What does that look like, right? And so we started looking at, gee, you know, it turns out that if developing countries had fairer, more transparent tax systems, they could increase tax collections 2 to 4% of GDP, which is 3 or 4 times ODA, right? And this is something that we saw in Haiti,
ODA,
right?
ODA is overseas. Excuse me. Yeah,
the foreign assistance, right? And we saw this in Haiti, where every one of our patients would get taxed every time they killed a goat. But there were a bunch of families who were legally exempted from paying taxes, the wealthiest families, right?
These systems are everywhere. And you know, we call it domestic resource mobilization, another piece of jargon. Illicit financial flows. Companies that don't pay taxes where they make money in poor countries because of terrible legal agreements. Also, oligarchs that just steal money and take it out. If we stop the so-called illicit financial flows, again, another huge piece of potential finance. And then you have official development assistance, foreign assistance, which is grant-based. But what we're looking at now is, well, why would you, if you could give, instead of a $20 million grant for a project that would last a year, if you could take that $20 million, come to organizations like us, we go to the capital markets, we raise money for very low rates because we have such a good AAA rating, we raise money and it's at very, very low rates. For those of you who know LIBOR minus probably 30 basis points, we raise money at very low rates. But then if you took that grant money and bought down the interest, we could give it to countries with a 40-year maturity at 0% interest, which is about 60% grant. So you increase the amount of money just by doing the grant. But if we watch the indebtedness, it's literally we get to trillions of dollars. Also, so much of the infrastructure that we build now, it doesn't need to be built with grant-based official development assistance. Can be done with public-private partnerships. So we actually got to the trillions. So how would you build healthcare systems in every single country in Africa that could improve outcomes, that could be part of the outbreak alert and response network, and also be the first step toward formal employment for so many people? You know, now that I see how this works, there's no question that there's enough money in the world to do all that. Now, you know, what it means is you have to get into the world of swaps and leverage and using your balance sheet, things that rich people do all the time for themselves, but now have to be done much more creatively for poor people because we can achieve those goals. So the denominator has always been hidden from global health people because the denominator is actually much, much larger than we could have ever imagined. Part of it is you just have to learn finance, right? So I see Vasant, right, in one of our medical students who went into the industry and understands what I'm talking about.
He better come back. But
this is why, you know, this is why I've been telling everybody over the last 5 or 6 years. You know, they're saying, I'm interested in global health. What should I study? I say finance,
so
economics.
So one time I came to see you at the bank, and we had lunch, and Jim told me, he said, I thought I understood global health before, but now I know that you need to know the money flows to know anything about this. So one of the questions I wanted to ask you is, what is it that we in global health need to understand about finance to do a better job? And I think switching from the B word to the T word and understanding that the resources are there. We don't have to live with this notion of scarcity that Paul mentioned. I want to ask you a question, Bill, that follows up on something Paul said. I want to turn global health equity on its head and ask you, what is it that makes people tolerate people living in conditions of poverty? Is there something that we think is different about poor people that makes that not so objectionable to us? If it hit us and if these conditions hit our families, there'd be a huge outcry, a huge outroar. We can't tolerate these things. But what is it about the way we think about the poor people in poverty that makes us much less up in arms?
But we think of poor people as deserving their place, and so we don't have to do anything about it. That's the way the world's set up. But let me take a couple steps to get there. Jim came to Seattle years ago to give a talk, long before anyone would have thought of him being at the World Bank, and I introduced him. And it was just after a report had come out in the news that we'd spent $75 billion in Iraq for something. And I said, what if we were suddenly told we had $75 billion for global health? How would we spend it? And I said, I'm not sure, but I know who I would want making those decisions, and I introduced Jim. Isn't that... poor, first of all, we tolerate it the way we used to tolerate slavery. We thought that's the way the world was. And so we didn't put ourselves in the position of the slave. We saw ourselves as being the plantation owner. And now everybody in this room is the plantation owner, because poor people subsidize everything you do. They make your food cheaper, your clothes cheaper, your travel cheaper, your hotel rooms cheaper, and because they're subsidizing you by working at low wages, sub-livable wages, and we all accept that. We should feel absolutely disgraced that we allow that to continue happening. So poverty is the slavery of today. Poor people are different. And one of the things that Harvard has recently been publishing on is something called the science of scarcity. And the economists there have gone back to World War II, where Ansel Keys at the University of Minnesota did studies where he would starve conscientious objectors and then bring them back to health in order to be prepared when we came to POW camps with starving people. And the economist at Harvard noticed in this big report, there was a small footnote on how those people changed their thinking, the people that were starving. And so he came up with the ideas, the science of scarcity. And he said they became so obsessed with food that they spend their days talking about recipes and exchanging recipes and talking about food, even though they couldn't have it. And he said, give me a rich person, allow me to make that person poor, and in a month they will be thinking like poor people. And so from the outside we say, well, why don't they vote and get some power? And the fact is, they can't do that. And whether the scarcity is sex or money or food, people start thinking in a different way. So these people are different. And as I heard the three of you talking, I was saying, you would never hear poor people talking with the kind of energy and the enthusiasm, and let's go from billions to trillions. I mean, they can't even think that way. And so from the outside, we have to stop saying, why don't they think like we do?
I just want to, and again, I'm another inveterate optimist, like everyone up here, in fact. But there is an added injury, which you've already mentioned, and that is that in projecting, low aspirations or lowball aspirations for others, we're doing that without even being subjected ourselves to any kind of privation. And, that's what really we were reacting against when we were in our 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s is, seeing how the failure to have an ambitious goal is something we're projecting. Like, we don't imagine for a minute that we're not going to eradicate polio in our families or counties, or we know we're going to. Indeed, we already have. But the idea that it is overly ambitious to eradicate polio or to put 3 million people on treatment a decade after effective therapy has been, identified, or that we could eradicate, filariasis or the horrible itching that you so beautifully, that reminds us that we can't keep on othering people like that and failing to make that, human connection. And I think that's why Mark asked you the question, is because to take these big ideas and these goals that are really quantitative and link them to the faces of people who are suffering or whose suffering is lessened, who suddenly aren't thinking of itching themselves with a rock the minute they wake up till the moment they fall asleep. That's a powerful part of what we need to keep moving forward to meet the goals that Jim describes and that you and others have described.
This has been a powerful discussion. I wish we could go on for another hour.
Don't we have another hour?
Please, do we have another hour, Paul? One more?
Can I tell one final
story?
I'm going to give each of you. We have been participants and observers of an incredible conversation and dialogue. Because we don't have that extra time, I do want to give each of you a chance to share with us some final thoughts that you think are particularly important and appropriate. And then we'll take some questions from the floor. But let me start, Bill, and we'll go around.
In 2 days in New York, the Hilton Humanitarian Award will be given out, and I have a chance to speak to the group. And I'm going to tell a story about that was on NPR just recently, where they had a TED Talk. And the TED Talk was on creativity. And the speaker said there was a group of small children in a classroom drawing pictures. And the teacher went to one small girl and asked, "What are you drawing?" She said, "I'm drawing a picture of God." And the teacher said, "No one knows what God looks like." And the girl said, "They will in a minute." No one knows what an equitable world looks like, but we will soon.
This notion that Paul and I have been working with for a long time, the notion of a preferential option for the poor, you know, Bill never put it this way, but everything he's done in his career simply reeks of it. And here's how I would put it. If the notion of a preferential option for the poor, and you know, I had the great good fortune of a meeting with Pope Francis, and I told him, I said, "This is what we've been doing." And he said, "This is exactly my philosophy." But here's the power of the notion of a preferential option for the poor. It doesn't mean that you don't care about everyone else, but at every step, your preference is for the poor. So the most important thing that most people don't get from this is that it doesn't then mean a preferential option for your program. It doesn't mean a preferential option for your own sense of personal efficacy. It doesn't mean a preferential option for labor unions. It doesn't mean a preferential option for an ideology or a way of thinking. It means a preferential option for the poor. So then when you get there, then you have to look desperately for evidence of what has worked. Partnerships have worked. And, you know, for me, the biggest thing was if we do not have growth in the private sector that creates jobs, we will never be able to end extreme poverty. And so people always ask me, "Why are you talking so much about the private sector?" Well, there's evidence. There's evidence is that in developing countries, 90% of all jobs are created in the private sector. You cannot government job your way out of extreme poverty. So I had to learn about the private sector. I had to learn about what it takes to get capital into the hands of young entrepreneurs and women and small and medium enterprises so that they can create jobs. And so for me, it was, oh my God, I really do have to give up a preferential option for liberal ideas or progressive ideas. I have to say what has worked. 70% of all people lifted out of extreme poverty were lifted out because of economic growth. And the rest, the 30%, are things like health and education and social protection programs. But here's the really great thing. The really great thing is that now we know that investing in health is directly correlated to economic growth, right? We didn't have that before. Thank you, Larry Summers, who's brought this home. 24% of the growth in full income, the way that poor people actually live, 24% of that from 2000 to 2011 is because of better health outcomes. Not more health expenditures, but better health outcomes. In education, we now know, it's a nice thing to do, it's a good thing to do. In education now, we know that the performance on PISA scores, the OECD's Program for International Student Assessment, is directly correlated to economic growth. Social protection programs, giving cash to poor people. Everyone said, "Oh, well, you know, that's going to make them not work." So you know what? At the bank, we actually studied that. We asked the question, does giving money to poor people make them not want to work? And it's just the opposite. They are advantaged to become part of the formal economy. And because poor people spend the money they get, economic growth in those regions where they got the cash payments is faster. Right? So the great news is that the evidence and data are catching up with our morals and our ethics. And I can say, investing in health and education, look, ministers of finance, you're crazy if you don't do this, because this is how you grow your economy, sometimes even in the short term, but definitely in the medium and long term. I can also, you know, we just came out with a report, demographics, that says, you know, for most aging societies, advanced societies that have growing aging populations, shrinking workforces, and low birth rates, best thing you can do is welcome refugees. So now I can say, you know, being xenophobic, and I got quoted as saying this, and I wasn't criticizing anybody, but, you know, xenophobia is actually now a bad economic strategy. So this is all really important. The evidence is falling the way of doing the right thing, and so you start with a huge, important goal. You make a preferential option for the poor in this case, and then you step to the evidence, and the evidence will take you in a direction that I'm so grateful seems to be so well aligned with the kind of values that Bill Foege has always been talking about.
Thanks, Jim. I wish we could go on not for an hour and a half, but for a day and a half more. Sidi, last comments.
Yes, just briefly. Jim, I'm so excited to hear about your enlightenment after you've become a banker, really. And just to say that we've been in discussion with the Economic Commission for Africa, with Carlos Lopez, yeah, on exactly the things that you are talking about, taxation, illicit financial flows out of the African region. And in efforts to try and think, so what would it take to turn the leadership in Africa around, the politicians, the ministers of finance, from that occasionally lamenting the fact that we have become a middle-income country now and we are no longer eligible for this and that funding, to thinking about the fact that these resources are potentially there in the countries, and the energy needs to be invested in liberating or managing to have these resources available, saving the time of some of the work that people have to do in order to sustain the ODA, and invest these internally in countries. Mm. Because the discussion very much is about, well, I'm not quite sure what you decided in Peru about the prospects in the future now that the price of oil and some commodities has dropped. And I'm being cautious about the statements I'm making about economic growth in Africa until I learn more. But clearly there are opportunities there that can be communicated by these leaders in their actions with the people, in the way that they're investing in health for their people, so that, oh, what you said, the poor people can be empowered and have aspirations that are different, and this will draw down from the leadership. So what can you do with these people when you're interacting with them as their world banker?
So, see, I'm thinking about, well, can we set a target for increased tax collection? And a target for how to be more fair about it, and then a transparent way of communicating how you spend it. Boy, you think I got in trouble for 3x5. If we do this, I'm going to really... But, I mean, why not? I mean, we're all going toward transparency. If you can increase your revenue 2-4% of GDP, that's huge. That could pay for all the health programs. And what a good way, a good sustainable way to pay for health programs. Start with a 0% interest loan for 5 years. During that time, commit to improving your domestic resource mobilization. You can support these health programs. I'm completely convinced of it.
So go get in trouble, Jim and Cindy. Yes. Go get your trouble seems to generate good things. Paul, let me turn to you, and I want you to be able to talk about anything you want, but I am aware that we've talked this whole time without mentioning the E word. We haven't talked at all about Ebola and any lessons that that's taught us about not just poor people, but poor countries.
Well, you know, I'm glad you bring it up, because it really, more than teaching us something new, teaches us something old. And almost all of the main lessons have already been raised, including the importance of investing in healthcare and education. I mean, if you compare Rwanda over the last decade, so Rwanda in 1995 was the poorest country on the face of the earth, highest infant mortality, maternal mortality, et cetera, just coming out of the genocide and war. And Sierra Leone and Liberia in 2002, 2003 were in that position after the end of their civil wars, fortunately not accompanied by a genocide, but horrific wars, brutal and destabilizing in every sense, basically ripped apart what fragile institutions existed there in one independent country in another former British colony. But what happened in the decade after that in those two places is also the story of Ebola, or the absence of Ebola in one place and its rapid spread in three other places, particularly. And I just would add that, going back to a point Jim made, again, to stick up for his pre-enlightenment, Jim pulled together a book based on very much on this 50 years is enough exercise, which was called Dying for Growth. And the point was not to make an ideological argument. So Jim, no, you don't have to cast away your progressive views. They're just as sound now as they were when you were reading Gramsci out loud with your mother, truly. Dying for growth just meant if everything is focused on the growth of GDP and not on the investment in healthcare and education and the creation of safety nets and the eradication of pathogens like smallpox, if we don't do that, you can have a very rapid growth in GDP. Sierra Leone, Liberia, and probably Guinea had some of the fastest growing GDPs over the last decade, higher often than two-digit growth. Rwanda had good growth, but not that high. But Rwanda put a huge fraction of its public budget into healthcare and education. Not huge enough, mind you, just much larger than other countries on that continent or in many other places in the world. And they had a return on it. They had a Chinese-style return in the sense of very small country, but large numbers of people pulled out of poverty. So, that's the way to make a preferential option to the poor, bring people out of poverty so that they're not poor anymore. Ebola is, it's rapid spread. If you look at that map, Mark, that's where those three countries come together, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea in this once heavily forested patch of very, very disturbed terrain. For 500 years, that place has been shaken up, for centuries. And once it jumped into humans, there was nothing in its way. No healthcare system, no surveillance capacity, no basic delivery capacity. And, so we're back to the same lessons, that it makes sense to invest in healthcare and education and human security. And the economists, of which I'm not one, I think will help us understand why that makes good sense economically, as well as morally, ethically, and in just this basic enlightenment belief in human progress.
Well, thanks, Paul. I do want to point out that the changes that happened in Rwanda didn't happen just because stuff happens, but Paul and Partners in Health convinced people there to make a big investment in primary health and healthcare, especially using community health workers, an idea that Jim and Paul had seen and used in Peru and Haiti and other places in the past. It made a huge difference to mobilize the community to build the infrastructure and care team that you need. Again, I want to see, are there questions, Paul, that we should take?
One or two quick ones.
With this panel, they're not one or two quick ones, but let's see what we can pick. What pearls of wisdom do you have for young people starting careers in global health? I'm going to start with you, Sidi, because once I let one of these other three talk, it won't be short.
Strings of pearls.
I think this is a very exciting time to be starting off in global health. There are lots of ideas out there. We're just embarking on this new agenda, which has built on a lot that we have learned about successful programs and the limitations of some of these programs, I would say. I think that, and it's a lesson that's also been reiterated here, the emphasis on linking science and numbers with people, with compassion, with people's faces. And I think if young people can keep that in mind in terms of how they shape their careers, how they think about how they want to influence global health, it'll make a lot of difference. Because at the end of the day, I think we can be carried away with ideas, with science, but they only bring us to a certain level. Beyond that, we need to really be thinking about ethics, principles, be very aware of how the gaps that we fail to fill translate into tragedies for people, and be focused on thinking about that as well, making that, shutting that circle, making that loop. That's what I would encourage.
Run the numbers and see the faces. Mm-hmm. Another pearl of wisdom, Bill, for young people?
I would encourage people to become generalists and specialists simultaneously. I mean, learn as much about the world and how it operates. You hear these people talking here, and you see how important that is, and then get a skill. But now you know where that skill fits into the big problem. And the other thing I would say, find good mentors. Mm-hmm. There are three things you want to learn in global health. One is philosophy, one skills, one knowledge. Philosophy is eternal, and you get this from good mentors. Skills are for a lifetime. Knowledge is so ephemeral, and that's where we spend our school time, is transferring knowledge. It should be trying to get the philosophy right.
Thanks, Bill. Jim?
I think the most important thing for young people, I think, is, you want me to move this down a little bit? I think the most important thing I would say, and what I usually say, is come to terms with why you're interested in this. And I think so many young people look at people like Paul and Bill and say, it's because I want to be heroic, right? And so many of them come into this business making a preferential option for their own personal heroism. And I just see them be very disappointed over time. And so I think I would say, listen to Bill's advice, right? What are the problems in global health that most need attention and that we don't have experts on? I think this whole thing about delivery is really, really important. I think finance is really important. I think having people who are both physicians and really understand how the world of money works is critically important. All these things I just talked to you about, leverage, all the stuff I learned over the last 3.5 years, I wish I would have known them 20 or 30 years ago. Skills like in engineering, where you really can think about process improvement so that we get the delivery pieces of it right. These are all skills that we never thought were relevant. And everyone said, I am going to go into the hinterlands like Paul and treat the poor. Okay, but I just have seen very few people who have the endurance of Paul to be able to continue to do that over a lifetime. They get frustrated over time. They say, wait a minute, the poor people were supposed to be grateful and compliant, and they never are, right? And so that runs out. So I think the philosophy part is terribly important. Come to terms with why you're doing it. Understand why you're doing it. If you can get to something like a preferential option for the poor, and like Bill has always done, said, it's not about me, it's not about my heroism, it's about somehow getting enough people around the table to actually solve the problem, that would be the most important thing I'd say. Yeah.
Should we also tell young people to be bankers?
I think that it's not that easy to go from being a pure banker to being a great worker in global health. But I think that, let me put it this way, you don't have to be a banker to understand finance. I think understanding finance is really important. Just understand how money works in this world. That, you know, let me put it this way. So the most rigorous and the most rigorous and attentive students of global market capitalism I've ever seen are the Chinese and Vietnamese Communist parties, right? Because they live in the world of the market. You know, if they do this or they do that, the market responds, their borrowing costs go up and down, there's no foreign direct investment. They're desperately trying to understand how to fit themselves into the global market capitalism, because they understand it's the water in which we all swim. So for example, the Vietnamese understood that their state-owned enterprises were... So state-owned enterprises, the state should own all the enterprises, but what was happening is that the state enterprises were so inefficient that tax money that could be used to provide health and education were going in to prop up the state-owned enterprises. So they came to us and they said, you know, we know what we need to do. We need to privatize. We need to bring in expertise. And we know that we could, first of all, sell a chunk of it and, you know, get $1 billion into our accounts. And then they would improve the functioning of it and pay taxes every year. Isn't that better than putting, you know, $100 million every year into a state-owned enterprise? And we'd say, yeah, but they'd say, well, we can't call it privatization. We're going to call it equitization because it sounds kind of like equal, right? And they did it, and they did it with all their companies. Their bleeding of cash into these inefficient state-owned enterprises went down. The efficiency of those state-owned enterprises went up. Tax revenue started flowing in rather than out. Not everywhere, right? But they're doing this, and I said to the head of the Vietnamese Communist Party, I said, and I couldn't resist, because this is a guy who'd received his PhD from the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics School of Social Sciences in a well-known field called party building. And I said to him, I said, Your Excellency, you know, I'm a social scientist too. And I was just wondering, how do you reconcile Vietnam's embrace of the market mechanisms with the philosophy of the Vietnamese Communist Party? Because, oh, it's very simple. We learned that in order to perfect Vietnamese socialism, we need faster economic growth and better job creation, so it's no problem. Right? So I would say, look, you know, if the Communist Party of Vietnam and China can get over this, medical students can learn too.
And for those of you who feel you've already embarked on a career in global health, don't feel discouraged. Jim did not start out thinking he'd become a banker and a world-class world banker. If he did, this friendship between Jim and Paul might have taken a slightly different route. Paul, let me come back to you, a pearl for young people.
Well, you know, I think it's been so beautifully laid out already about the difference between skills and knowledge and the importance of a moral framework. You know, I think Jim and I, we never wasted any time, and with our other peers our age, we wasted a lot of time, but we didn't waste time agonizing over our roles and what it is we like to do. Now, we did spend time agonizing it. I just don't feel like it was wasted, right? And could you shorten that time and you find out, well, what is it exactly, given an ambition to have a moral framework or a philosophy? Yes, we're required to understand knowledge, but it changes so rapidly. So that gets to skill set. And I think, you know, students of global health don't need to go into medicine or nursing or epidemiology or high finance or low finance. They don't need to go in anything at all. In particular, they just need to go into something that will please them over, you know, at least make it 10 or 20 years, right? It's okay to change, you know, but 10-year chunks are good. So find something that you know you're really going to like and develop that skill set. And it just, you know, the rest of it comes out of community anyway, even the learning of the skill sets. But, you know, the discussion, if the students here knew how many years Jim and I spent hashing out areas of moral clarity and other kind of goofy but useful terms that led us to preferential option for the poor. You'd probably chuckle, but it was time well spent. I don't think we wasted any of that time. I hope you don't either.
It was learning time. Let me finish. Thanks, Paul. Thanks, CD. Thanks, Jim and Bill. One last question. I'm just going to have you answer this, Bill. And the question is, for the future of global health, is the glass half full or half empty?
It's filling so fast that makes no sense.
Do you want to explain the
answer?
Thus spake Gandalf.
let me thank the panelists. This has been an extraordinary honor and pleasure. I've gained both knowledge, wisdom, and some skills in listening and being with these people over my lifetime and today. But join me in thanking them so much.
So I want to introduce now a very special person. I think he's an extraordinary person. And it's the person who will be taking over the task force for me. Dave Ross has been at the task force more than 12 years. He comes from a varied background. I think he started out on a ranch, learned how to ride when he was three by riding on sheep, falling off and eating the dust and getting back up and going again. And then Dave grew up to like flying fast jets and did that for the United States. He was a nuclear scientist for a while. He ran a government hospital, and then he came to work for CDC, transformed the information capacity of CDC with the help from Pete McTeer and the Woodruff Foundation, and then went on to work for Cerner, a private firm, and then came back to the CDC and transformed one of our programs, All Kids Count, into what's probably the premier public health informatics center of teaching and transformation in the world, the Public Health Informatics Institute. We have been working on this transition for 2 years. It's been an extraordinary pleasure to work with Dave. He brings incredible insight into what makes public health and global health go. And maybe more important, as Jim was talking about, he knows what makes public health and global health stop. He knows where the problems are in collecting and using information. And Dave has an extraordinary generosity of spirit. He never turns away. This is a Bill Foege-like quality. He never walks away from someone with a question who's asking for help. To me, that's an extraordinary capacity. And Dave is one of the leading architects on this new CHAMPS program that the Gates Foundation is going to invest in for 20 years and more than $1 billion to find out what's killing kids in Africa and South Asia. And Dave is an extraordinary leader. I couldn't imagine a better person to take over at the task force. So it's with great pleasure that I give you Dave.
As usual, Mark was too generous in his remarks and introduction. I'm just honored and humbled to be able to be here today. A bit stunned, actually, for a kid who grew up in Wyoming to be on a stage and be in the midst of such global leaders. And so I thank Mark for everything he's done. I also want to say that this event is Mark. This movie, everything about it, the vision for all of that really came from that man. And Mark, so that this doesn't get away, let's thank you. I have to be honest, I'm not the guy who thinks up, let's have a party like this or let's make a movie like that. There were some other words said this morning about Dr. Bill Foege. So true: warmth, charm, vision, leadership. And I thought I should add to that, Bill, salesmanship. Bill knows how to sell ideas, and that's something I think we all need to learn from. So as I prepare to take on this role, I know I'm filling very large shoes of two men I greatly admire, Mark and Bill. It is their legacy that will continue to propel our organization forward. I was asked to talk about what does the next 30 years look like? And what I think I can say is that in collaboration with WHO, the World Bank, and in partnership with many other NGOs and governments and businesses and funding sources, and yes, even the United States public health system, we will join together to offer guidance and assistance to countries and here in the U.S., the states, to seek who seek to protect and promote the health of their citizens and to be able to respond to threats to health. And, of course, threats will continue to emerge. So none of us can foretell the future, yet I think we can see some trends that matter and that we ought to pay attention to. For example, the ways that technology will diagnose diseases closer to the point of care and to the point of intervention. The ways in which the internet is bringing knowledge and information, educational access to many, many people, or at least those who have access to it. And there's the rub. It's been spoken to eloquently this morning. There are many who have no access. So the world continues to witness disparities in care and access to care and painful inequities in health, and that is something that we at the task force are committed to do something about. So much will change, but several things will not. One of those things that will not change is the fundamental underpinning of the task force model. As Bill Foege explained this morning, the model is still relevant today. The values that guide our work, compassion, collaboration, stewardship, and global health equity are the foundation of every one of our programs, and these values focus our efforts and underscore our contributions in the global health arena, and is what have these values are what stand behind making us impactful. Compassion and collaboration represent the heart and mind of the task force. For those most in need, we link our compassion to action. Some people call us do-gooders, but we're tenacious do-gooders, and we will keep at it and we will stop at nothing until we get results. So at the task force, collaboration never goes out of style. Solutions to almost every health problem require multiple parties being involved. We have very few, if any, real silver bullet therapies. In fact, the solution involves understanding a society's culture, its politics, its traditions, and coupling that with the scientific knowledge that we all possess. Bringing that together is what yields change. So over the past 30 years, we have earned the trust and respect of many partners. The confidence that they have given in us enables us to bring others and organizations together to find solutions. We will continue to collaborate as a means of addressing the most challenging health problems. I'm very proud that of how the task force works to manage itself like a top-performing organization or top-performing business. This past year, our expenses were about roughly 10% or less of our annual cash revenue. The rest of our resources are applied to our program work to bring about impact. So going forward, we will take our stewardship and our business-like approach to the next level. We will strive harder to measure the benefits of our work. And that's not easy to do in the nonprofit world we live in, but it's something we must do. We have an obligation to know that the resources that are entrusted to us are, in fact, bringing about the benefits we said they would have. But we have to do that in a way that inspires others, that gets them to see the vision of what's possible. We are indeed fortunate to have funders and supporters like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation or the de Beaumont Foundation or the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. We have an obligation to handle their resources wisely. So we are grateful to these foundations, to our other business partners, who make it possible for us to improve the health and well-being of people throughout the world. As I look at the next 30 years for the task force, I know we have more to do in the areas with which in which we are working. Thanks to those of you in the room, many of our partners represented here, hundreds of millions of people's lives have been made better, and many, many millions and possibly billions of people have not died because of your work. We certainly celebrate the tremendous impact that we've had, and at the same time, we also recognize how much more there is to be done. And I think one of, it's already been mentioned, but one of the biggest threats to health are non-communicable diseases. Diseases like cardiovascular disease or diabetes or cancer or injuries. They've all reached epidemic proportions in many parts of the world. So the task force, I think, is really well positioned to tackle these challenges. And as was said in the movie, and I'll say it again, we will. So we must work harder to share progress that's been made in the U.S. public health community with others throughout the world, and vice versa. It is worth saying that the U.S., I say this to my U.S. colleagues often, we are a part of global health. And guess what? There are innovations happening in some of the poorest places that we can benefit from. And in many ways, the U.S. public health community can catch up by paying close attention to what is happening in other parts of the world. I see a tremendous opportunity to use to increase the use of our information and laboratory technologies to address global health issues. We've seen technological innovation applied even in the poorest and most remote parts of the world. Through our work in neglected tropical diseases, we've are seeing an enormous potential for applying these technologies to address a range of health issues. So at the individual level, at the population level, and at the level at which policies are made, health is becoming increasingly data-driven. So we will continue to marry technology with information to address global health problems. Starting this year, the task force, through our partnership with the Emory Global Health Institute, as Mark mentioned and has been mentioned earlier today, we have joined with Emory Global Health Institute in the CHAMPS program, which is devoted to understanding why so many children get severely ill and die in the poorest places and doing something about it. We are proud to be able to be a part of addressing this, and I have to say that I'm very thankful that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation wants to take on the challenge of helping build surveillance capacity and primary care capacity, because this ultimately is what will change some of the trajectory in many places of high mortality. I have one thing, though, to say that we are a growing organization, happily so. And we're growing because we've, on the whole, done very impactful, useful things. But the downside to growth is that we're outgrowing our current home. Our lack of office space is becoming a challenge. In fact, we're in the process of looking for more office space. And this is something that needs to be addressed in both our domestic and our global work. So in my opinion, applying our existing expertise is not enough. Given the scale of health inequities that we see throughout the world, I feel that we have an obligation to grow and to continue our work. In fact, all of us, all of my colleagues at the task force know lives depend upon it. Our history of helping those in need and forging a bond with partners to solve global health problems is an amazing legacy to leverage. We have touched hundreds of millions of lives. I've referred to our work as an obligation, but really to me, it's a privilege. And I know I speak for my colleagues, it is our collective privilege. Truly doing what I do gives meaning to my life. It's why I get up in the morning and want to come to work. And I just can't think of doing anything that would be more rewarding than working here at the task force with my colleagues. These are inspirational people. We've seen it. Our panelists have shown us what an inspiration it is to be around people who lead. I'm thrilled to be able to be a part of an organization that has played such a role. So do we have big challenges in front of us? Yes, of course we do. But more importantly, we have the energy and the heart to face those challenges and to create a better world. This is what keeps me going, and I know it keeps my colleagues going. With that, I want to say thank you for giving me the opportunity, Mark, and the board. I will do my best, and I know because I work with such great people, we will rise to the challenges. Thank you very much. And now it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Jim Laney, former president of Emory University, former ambassador to South Korea, former emeritus board chairman of the task force, and all-around brilliant person, and one of many with whom I'm very thankful to be able to be associated. Dr. Laney.
This late hour, I'm very conscious of the fact that I'm a little caboose following enormous engines that have run ahead of me. And I find it a great privilege to have a chance to say just a few words. I'm, as you are, struck and stunned by the vision and the remarkable reach of the panel that preceded us today. The world that they open up to address global inequity and all that means for well-being as well as eradication of disease and health is something that I think we not only applaud, but we really endorse with all that we have. And as I've thought about the things that make the task force so special, of course, it's the people. Bill Foege, Mark, now Dave, and all the staff. But the thing that I was struck by in listening to the panel today and their remarks was the underlying fact of a deep, abiding, and powerful, and motivating commitment. This commitment which gave them the capacity to subordinate self in the pursuit of something much greater, a mission, a vision. And that vision was so beautifully amplified by Bill Foege today when he talked about the early days of the task force and the days in Bellagio. That vision would not have been possible without the commitment of Bill Foege, but the commitment is something that he brought to it that allowed him to speak in a way, and Mark has carried this on, that invites trust and confidence, that minimizes rivalry and vanity and ego, without which there could be no collaboration. So the task force really embodies not only the expertise and scientific advances and understanding that go with public health, but it also embodies that commitment to a vision which makes it possible for it not to be a rival of the other organizations that have been brought together under its aegis. So it's commitment and it's collaboration. And also it's a matter of, I think, that Mark has particularly talked about a good deal in the last few years. It's compassion. And we often think of compassion as something simply sentimental, romantic, but compassion really in its derivation means to suffer with, to stand alongside, to enter into the lives of, to understand, to be with, and how important that is as we move forward in the whole area of poverty, which is not merely addressed by science or medicine or organization or even electronics, but it has to be addressed in terms of culture and the way people live and how they see life and what they respond to. That compassion enables us to cross that line into their lives in a way that engenders their trust and their confidence, without which nothing can be received that would be lasting. So it's commitment that makes it possible for people to trust the organization. It's collaboration that brings the organizations together vertically and horizontally, but it's compassion that will carry the ball on down the road in the future. And that compassion is absolutely essential. I think we all learn from the Ebola crisis, bracketing the issue of slow response and inadequate resources and so forth at the beginning. The fact is that Ebola, where it was so extant, was really compounded by suspicion, fear, vulnerability, evasion, rejection. And it was very hard to overcome that. And this is what we face when we talk about poverty. We're also dealing not with a top-down or something that is a data a point in the issue of statistics. It's realizing that without people who understand and are with and appreciate and even are involved in the suffering of these people, then, only then, was it possible for these great dreams to come alive. And I think this is the next era of the task force, to take what's been done with such extraordinary success, almost beyond imagination, with the possible exception of Bill Foege. The fact is that to take that, the sense of commitment, how to make that transferable to others, to the younger generation, who are looking for something to commit their lives to. This is what the task force can hold forth. It is embodied in the lives of those who sat on the stage today in spades. I just would like to see their lives replicated across the board in all the college campuses of America and around the world, for that matter. And that's that commitment then allows and enables collaboration. But then the collaboration and commitment, the means, the resources, the ends, have to be accompanied by this sense of compassion, which is not just a matter of do-goodism. This is the most important thing in the world, the capacity to cross those lines and to enter into those lives. And I know that because of the extraordinary legacy that is the task force today, that compassion will in fact enable the new era of the task force to be something that is as glorious, as noble, and as fulfilling as the last 30 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. You stir us on, you comfort us and lead us forward and reinforce the commitment that we have made and will continue going forth. I hate to end what has been a spectacular day. I talked before about the intergenerational transmission of knowledge. I'll change that, Bill, to knowledge, skills, and wisdom. But Beckett wrote a play about what happens when there's a failure of the intergenerational transmission of knowledge, and it's you have two men in garbage cans with civilization destroyed and nothing good left around. Endgame. Endgame is the play. It's an extraordinary play. and it's about the failure of intergenerational transmission of knowledge. This has been a spectacular day for it. And I should say that the intergenerational transmission works both ways. I can't refer to Paul and Jim as the kids who taught me so much anymore. But I think it goes in both directions. And I think today has been a spectacular day for the transmission of knowledge among all of us. The last thing I want to say is, while you have seen a few speakers up here on the stage, and I come back to my brother's statement that the root of all evil is the belief that some lives are worth more than others. Thank you, Paul. This task force is not just a leader or a spectacular previous leader. This task force is a lot of lives working very hard, changing a lot of lives. We haven't had the opportunity to acknowledge all of our staff, but if there are any program directors or senior staff here, just stand up for a second. This is a spectacular, it is a spectacular, spectacular team. And I have been very, very lucky to work with such extraordinary people. Every one of them follows the mandates that you heard. Everyone could teach us pearls of wisdom, and I am deeply grateful to all of you. I want to thank all of you for coming. I want to thank particularly the panelists and the people who spoke. I have rarely been so inspired. It's been wonderful to be a part of it, to share the stage with you from whom I have learned so much, and I'm very deeply grateful to all of you for coming. Again, thank you so much. I don't know if there's any other housekeeping announcements I am supposed to make. I'm looking for Paul. That's it. Thank you so much for everything, for your support. We will go forward. We will stay in touch and continue to learn from you and share with you. Thanks so much.